Race and ethnicity have defined every nation on Earth, except one, the United States of America. It is defined by values. So to understand America, you have to understand American values. They are 1, e pluribus unum, 2, liberty, 3, in God we trust. I call this the American Trinity. I made up the name, but I didn't make up the values. They are on every American coin. The first, e pluribus unum, is Latin, meaning out of many, one. When first adopted as an American motto, shortly after the American founding in 1776, it referred to the 13 American colonies becoming one nation. Over time, however, most Americans understood the motto to mean one people from many backgrounds. To quote the E Pluribus Unum Project, funded by the National Endowment for the Humanities, over the years, E Pluribus Unum has also served as a reminder of America's bold attempt to make one unified nation of people from many different backgrounds and beliefs. In other words, America doesn't care about your national or ethnic origins. This explains why people who immigrate to America assimilate faster and more fully than immigrants to any other country. Most of those who have immigrated to Europe from, for example, Turkey, as millions have, are not considered fully German by fellow Germans or fully Swedish by fellow Swedes or fully Spanish by fellow Spaniards. This is even true of the children and grandchildren of those immigrants. And just as important, few of those immigrants or their children or grandchildren will ever feel fully German, Swedish, or Spanish. But a Turk who immigrates to the United States will be regarded as fully American as any other American, the moment he or she becomes a citizen. And they, and certainly their children, will feel fully American. Of course, America has not always lived up to this e pluribus unum ideal, but the ideal was always there, and it was applied to virtually every immigrant to America. The second component of the American Trinity is liberty. Now you might ask, didn't the French Revolution also enshrine liberty as a central national value? Wasn't its motto liberty, equality, fraternity? The answer is yes. America is hardly the only country to enshrine liberty. It is the only country to enshrine liberty e pluribus unum and in God we trust. What's the difference? The difference is this. The moment you affirm equality, as the French Revolution did, you will lose liberty. It is a basic American value that all human beings are born equal and all must be equal before the law. But ending up equal, that's a French and European value. And if you want people to end up equal, you must deprive them of liberty, which is exactly what happened right after the French Revolution and in every other society that made equality its national goal. America gives people the liberty to end up wherever their abilities, work ethic, and luck take them, meaning unequal. Therefore, professional athletes will make more money than teachers or doctors. That may be unfortunate, but that is what liberty allows. If you want equality, you will tell people how much they can earn, and that means the end of liberty. And third, in God we trust. Unlike almost every other country, America never had a state religion. But it was founded on the principle that God, specifically the God of the Bible, is the source of moral values. As the Declaration of Independence put it, all people are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. In other words, rights come from God, not from men. If rights are given by men, men can take them away. The American Trinity is the reason America became the world's freest and most prosperous country. But many Americans want to, in the words of former President Barack Obama, fundamentally transform it. They wish to replace American values with European values. Equality of result and an ever-expanding state, which greatly reduce individual freedom. The celebration of ethnic and racial identity, which is the opposite of e pluribus unum, and the removal of God as the source of morality and rights. Which set of values Americans adopt will determine whether America remains free, prosperous, and the force for good in the world that it has been. With the exception of the Civil War, this is the greatest internal battle in American history. I'm Dennis Prager.
I want to talk to you about a new feminism for the 21st century. There are three pillars to this new feminism: dignity, the word no, and men. That's right, men. But before I expound on these three ideas, you need to know something about me. I was very involved in the feminist movement, including being on the board of directors of the National Organization for Women. For this, I feel much pride and some guilt. Pride because feminism has pushed forward some very important and needed changes, and guilt because it has also done a lot of damage. My work now is to reverse that damage. So in that spirit, let's talk about the first pillar of this new feminism, dignity. Dignity is at the core of what feminism should always be about. Dignity means that a woman should be able to freely choose her own path in life. That's what feminism once held. But does it still? Ask almost any female college student today what she aspires to be, and she'll list any number of career choices. The one she won't list is wife and mother. In fact, any time someone has the temerity to suggest that a woman might want to look for a husband while in college, as a very successful Princeton grad recently did in a letter to the school's newspaper, feminists go nuts. A new feminism will value and respect all responsible choices. And while we're talking about dignity, I can't think of anything less dignified for women than the feminist belief that in the sexual arena, women are like and therefore ought to act like men. Is this what the truly liberated woman wants? To have casual sex and think nothing of it like men do? That's what feminism aspires to? Sad to say, the answer has too often been yes. So let's add this up. Feminism has downplayed the desire for women to have a family, while at the same time hyping the rewards of career and casual sex. Not exactly a recipe for success or happiness. The second pillar of a new feminism is the word no. It's very much tied in with the first pillar. Throughout history, women have made great use of the word no.
No.
Of course, many times women said yes when they should have said no, and that's the basis of more than a few classic stories and novels. But this was the exception, not the rule. There is great power in that word no, and women, for the most part, knew how to wield that power. But in the last few decades, they've lost it, and the consequences have been catastrophic. Women who fought not to be treated as sex objects have become more objectified than ever. You see it everywhere, in music videos, on billboards, in the hookup culture, on campuses. And now we have the tawdry spectacle of teenage girls sexually pursuing teenage boys the way boys pursued girls. How did this happen? Because feminism began to advocate that women should behave like men. Whatever men did and however they did it, that's what women should do. Feminists were angry at men, but they wanted to be like them at the same time. No wonder our society is so confused. Women are robbing themselves of the ability to say no. The solution is to take that power back. This is especially true for young women.
No.
Saying no means I will not be defined by anyone else, not by feminists, and not by men's sexual desires. That is female power. This is a good segue to my third pillar of a new feminism, men. It is easy for feminists to forget this, but it was men who gave up their monopoly on political power and gave women the right to vote. Men who invented birth control, the refrigerator, the washing machine, and so many other devices that liberated women. And men are different from women. Academics like to speculate that men and women are basically the same, that they're only socialized differently. But as George Orwell famously noted, that's an idea that only an intellectual would be foolish enough to believe. Moreover, the sexes need each other. For example, women civilize men. It's what we're supposed to do. But in order to accomplish this critical task, we must preserve our dignity, not be afraid to use the word no, and see men as partners, not as competitors, let alone oppressors. That's the way to a new feminism and the way to a better world for both sexes. I'm Tammy Bruce for Prager University.
You know, for 27 years, I was an atheist. I thought anyone who believed in a god or gods was, well, stupid or uneducated, naive, gullible, or just into the gig for money, sex, and power. I mean, after all, everyone knows that religion is just a psychological crutch for intellectual weaklings, right? So, what changed my mind? Well, look, I tell the whole story in my book, Shattered, but for our purposes here on Prager University, I was simply challenged by my Christian teammates on the Cincinnati Reds to read some religious books, critique them, and then share with the guys where the authors were wrong and why atheism is the only real and true outlook for anyone not deceived by fantasy, fiction, or mythology. I mean, for someone who wants to base their beliefs and values upon evidence and argument, not emotion and tradition. Now look, simply put, I set out to disprove theism, which I didn't think would take very long. But I ran into some difficulties along the way. Difficulties like Aristotle, Augustine, Aquinas. I mean, in simple terms, I was confronted with the awareness that there are really four big bangs that have to be accounted for, not just one. I had never really even considered that before. I mean, we're all familiar with the first big bang, right? It's usually the answer given to the question, why is there something rather than nothing? It's the idea that there was nothing, it popped, and boom, there's something. I mean, that time, matter, and space all came into existence in some great cosmological flash about 16 billion years ago. There was no gradual development, no transitional forms, just a binary flip, a metaphysical, now you don't see it, and now you do. Fine, I want to follow the evidence wherever it leads. However, astrophysicists tell us that this first Big Bang yielded only a handful of fundamental elements and that it would take billions and billions of years for the nuclear furnaces of trillions of stars to yield the 118 elements in the periodic table. But the first theoretical cosmological Big Bang, well, it only yields matter and energy. It doesn't even begin to address the origin of life. So, how do you get life from non-life? How did abiogenesis occur? I mean, the notion that something can come from nothing. Where's the evidence? Well, you're going to need another something from nothing leap of faith, some kind of biological second Big Bang. For all the mind-blowing advancements we've made in physics, biology, and chemistry in just the past 100 years, we're still no closer to making it happen. We don't have a clue. The closer we look, the wider the chasm. I mean, sure, we've learned a lot about how to manipulate life forms, how to add and subtract DNA material, even map the human genome, but we have no idea how to literally create life from dead stuff. Now look, at this point, we still only have physics, chemistry, and some basic biology, or matter, energy, and simple life, if you will, but we still don't have a way to account for the great diversity of life forms. I mean, the huge differences between bacteria, plants, and animals. Nor do we have a way to account for the differences between man and animal. We still don't have an anthropology at this point. So we're gonna need a kind of anthropological third Big Bang to account for all this, which of course is what Darwin was after in his Descent of Man thesis. Now look, Darwin answered a lot of questions, but he could never answer the core question. How did evolution begin? But hey, we're still not done describing the world that is all around us. A final Big Bang is going to be required to explain how a mechanistic animal brain can become a self-reflective human mind. Even the lowest life forms have brains and central nervous systems. I mean, how does something like that become the mind of a Michelangelo, a Shakespeare, a Beethoven? Come on, animals don't do art, and they don't appreciate beauty. But the problem is even more basic than that. How do you account for free will and introspection, let alone man's pressing existential drive to ask why? Well, we're going to need some kind of psychological fourth Big Bang to account for man's moral and aesthetic sense. I mean, his search for meaning, significance, and purpose. And of course, his appreciation for the true, the good, and the beautiful. And again, you must understand these problems require bangs. I mean, sudden binary pops into existence, since there's no evidence for any gradual development in any of these. So I, like you, have a choice. It's either faith in these four big bangs of somethings from nothings to account for what we see all around us, or faith in some kind of creator God behind it all. So, next time someone asks you, hey, what about the Big Bang? Make sure you ask them, which one? The cosmological, biological, anthropological, or psychological? I'm Frank Pastore for Prager University.
Most people think of happiness as essentially a selfish issue. I want to be happy, and I want to be happy for me. I'd like to suggest that, in fact, happiness is far, far more than a selfish desire. In fact, it is a moral obligation. I know that most people have never thought of happiness in this way. Neither did I, to tell the truth, for much of my life. I thought that happiness, and especially the pursuit of happiness, was all about oneself. But it isn't. Whether or not you're happy, and most importantly, whether or not you act happy, is about altruism, not selfishness, because it is about how we affect others' lives. And that's what makes it a moral issue. Ask anybody who was raised by an unhappy parent whether or not happiness is a moral issue, and I assure you the answer will be yes. It is no fun being raised by an unhappy parent, or being married to an unhappy person, or being the parent of an unhappy child, or working with an unhappy coworker. Our happiness affects others profoundly. That's why happiness is a moral obligation. We are morally obligated to at least act as happy as possible, even if we don't feel happy. People can't be guided by feelings because it is how we act that affects others, not how we feel. A good analogy to bad moods is bad breath. Why do we brush our teeth multiple times every day? It's not only because of hygiene, it's because we want to present good breath to anybody who we come into contact with. Well, the same thing holds true for our moods. A bad mood should be regarded exactly as we regard bad breath. Why are you inflicting it on me, or why am I inflicting it on you? It's just not right. That's why one should endeavor as much as possible to act as happy as possible, as often as possible. And just about anyone can do this. No matter how unhappy you may feel at any given moment, you can and have to make a decision on how to act. We may not be free to control whether we feel sad or happy, but we are free to control whether or not we present a happy countenance to others. That doesn't mean we don't share how we feel with our best friends, including hopefully our spouse. Of course we can, and without overdoing it, we should. You know, I'm really sad. I had this problem at work today. I have this problem with my marriage. I have this problem with my kid. I have this problem with my parents. But you don't inflict a bad mood on anybody. That's a different thing altogether. We all have the capacity to control how we express ourselves, no matter how we feel. I can prove it. Imagine someone who is just acting miserably to his or her spouse when somebody comes to the door. Have you ever noticed how nicely such a person will treat the stranger? How were they able in a split second to go from inflicting their awful mood on their spouse to acting beautifully toward the stranger who's at the door? Obviously, we can control our moods. Or how about this? Let's say you are chronically in a bad mood and I offered you $10,000 a week not to be in a bad mood. Do you think this would affect your ability to be in a good mood? I suspect so. And to be honest, we even have the power to affect how we feel, not only how we act. Abraham Lincoln famously said that we are as happy as we decide to be. That is exactly what we should decide. Being happier is good for us, and it is what we owe everybody who is in our lives. Becoming happier is another great benefit of acting happy. The happier we act, the happier we will feel. We think that our actions are determined by our feelings, but we have the power to achieve the opposite.
to shape our feelings by our actions. How we act influences our feelings more than our feelings should ever be allowed to influence our behavior. So yes, indeed, we do have a moral obligation to be, or at least to act, happy. The happy make the world better, and the unhappy make it worse. Happiness is a huge issue. Lincoln was right. We are as happy as we decide to be. And it's time to make that decision. I'm Dennis Prager.
A lot of the things that are wrong with the world, we can't fix by ourselves. As much as we'd like to see peace brought to troubled areas, corrupt governments reformed, cancers cured, there's a limited amount that any of us as individuals can do about such things. However, there is one thing that nearly all of us can do that will immediately and exponentially increase goodness and happiness on Earth. Parents and all other adults should reserve their highest praise of children for when their children do kind acts. That is not the case at present. As a rule, children receive their highest compliments for one of four things: their intellectual and academic achievements. My son, Sean, is brilliant. His teacher says he's the best student she's had in years. Their athletic abilities, their artistic attainments, and in the case of girls, their looks. Children who receive their parents' and other adults' compliments in these areas are delighted. Everyone loves compliments. But what about the child who doesn't excel at academics, who isn't a gifted athlete or dancer, the girl who is not particularly pretty? About what will their parents praise them? The most flattering remark such a child is likely to hear their parents tell others will be something like, "But he or she is a really good kid," from which it can generally be inferred that being a good kid is not a big deal. That from the parents' perspective, the child is probably not very good at anything worth talking about. Some parents to whom I've made this proposal have told me it's unnecessary. They're certain that they have successfully communicated to their children that being a good person is what really matters most to them. By and large, these parents are deluding themselves. And there is a way for parents to find out if this is so. For many years, Dennis Prager has suggested that parents ask their children, "What do you think that I, your mother, or I, your father, most want you to be? Successful, smart, good, or happy?" Many parents who have conducted this experiment have been quite surprised to learn that their children did not think that being good was what mattered most to their parents. Try it yourself. Ask your child of any age that question, "What do you think I most want you to be?" I want to make it clear, I am not suggesting that parents stop complimenting their children for their accomplishments in other areas. All children want to know that their parents have respect for their accomplishments, and girls, even more than boys, also need to feel that they are physically attractive. But, and this is an important but, what I'm suggesting is this. The traits that we most often emphasize and praise are all important only if being a good person is placed at the top of the list. But then you might say, don't these traits have a value in and of themselves, independent of goodness? The answer is no, they don't. Germany did not start World War II and carry out the Holocaust because it lacked intelligence or cultured people, but because it lacked enough good people. Now, what do I mean when I speak about young people being good? Let me cite a few examples. Speaking out against and confronting a school bully. Befriending a new kid at school who isn't popular.
Hi.
Finding a wallet or cell phone and making every effort to locate the owner instead of keeping it. Offering one's seat on a bus to an older person.
Thank you.
Treating one's siblings decently. Not cheating on tests. And much more. Note, however, I didn't list among my examples going on a 10K walk for a good cause, like cancer research. That is, of course, a very worthwhile thing for a young person to do. But it's not really what I'm talking about. I'm talking about individual, one-to-one acts of goodness, of integrity. Why will parents reserving their highest praise for their child's goodness and integrity have so powerful an impact? Because children will then ultimately identify feeling good about themselves with being a good person. they will most like themselves when they act nobly. Or to put it another way, their self-esteem will come more from their goodness than from anything else. What a world that would be. And the best news about this proposal is that you can start doing it immediately. And I don't mean tomorrow. I mean now. I'm Joseph Telushkin for Prager University.
Try this at your next party. Ask your guests to define the term social justice. Okay, it's not charades or Twister, but it should generate some interesting conversation, especially if your guests are on the political left. Since everyone on that side of the spectrum talks incessantly about social justice, they should be able to provide a good definition, right? But ask 10 liberals to tell you what they mean by social justice, and you'll get 10 different answers. That's because social justice means anything its champions want it to mean. Almost without exception, labor unions, universities and colleges, private foundations, and public charities claim at least part of their mission to be the spreading of social justice far and wide. Here's the mission statement of the AFL-CIO, but it could be the mission statement for 1,000 such organizations. Quote, "The mission of the AFL-CIO is to improve the lives of working families, to bring economic justice to the workplace, and social justice to our nation." In short, social justice is code for good things no one needs to argue for and no one dare be against. This very much troubled the great economist Friedrich Hayek. This is what he wrote in 1976, 2 years after winning the Nobel Prize in Economics. "I have come to feel strongly that the greatest service I can still render to my fellow men would be that I could make the speakers and writers among them thoroughly ashamed ever again to employ the term social justice." Why was Hayek so upset by what seems like such a positive and certainly unobjectionable term? Because Hayek, as he so often did, saw right to the core of the issue. And what he saw frightened him. Hayek understood that beneath the political opportunism and intellectual laziness of the term social justice was a pernicious philosophical claim, namely that freedom must be sacrificed in order to redistribute income. Ultimately, social justice is about the state amassing ever-increasing power in order to do good things. What are good things? Well, whatever the champions of social justice decide this week. But first, last, and always, it is the cause of economic redistribution. According to the doctrine of social justice, the haves always have too much, and the have-nots never have enough. You don't have to take my word for it. That is precisely how a UN report on social justice defines the term. Quote, "Social justice may be broadly understood as the fair and compassionate distribution of the fruits of economic growth. Social justice is not possible without strong and coherent redistributive policies conceived and implemented by public agencies." Let me repeat that. Strong and coherent redistributive policies conceived and implemented by public agencies. And it gets worse. The UN report goes on to insist that, quote, "Present-day believers in an absolute truth identified with virtue and justice are neither willing nor desirable companions for the defenders of social justice." Translation? If you believe truth and justice are concepts independent of the agenda of the forces of progress as defined by the left, you are an enemy of social justice. Compassion, or social justice, is when government takes your money and gives it to someone else. Greed is when you want to keep it. The underlying point of social justice, then, amounts to a sweeping indictment of a free society. It suggests that any perceived unfairness or sorrow or economic want must be addressed by yet another government effort to remedy that unfairness, that sorrow, or that economic want. All we need to do is invoke the abracadabra phrase, social justice, and we're on our way. The invocation of social justice always works from the assumption that the right people, the anointed few, can simply impose fairness, prosperity, and any other good thing you can think of. and the only institution capable of imposing social justice is the state. And keep in mind, the conventional wisdom among liberal elites is that conservatives are the ones who want to impose their values on everyone else. The self-declared champions of social justice believe the state must remedy, and can remedy, all perceived wrongs. Anyone who disagrees is an enemy of what is good and right. And the state must therefore coerce them to do what is socially just. And that, as Hayek prophesized, is no longer a free society. Is that the kind of society you want to live in? If it isn't, beware of what will be done in the name of social justice. I'm Jonah Goldberg of the American Enterprise Institute and National Review for Prager University.
There are two important, indeed fundamental, questions you have to answer in life. The first is there a God, specifically a moral and judging creator? The second is, are people basically good? Your answer to the second question will shape just about all of your moral, social, and political views, even more than whether you believe in God. That's why a believer and an atheist who have the same views about human nature almost always have the same social and political views. Let me give you some examples. You've probably heard the phrase, poverty causes crime. If you believe that people are basically good, you are likely to believe that poverty or bigotry or some other outside force causes people to commit violent crime. That's the only way you can make sense of the fact that some people commit crimes despite their basically good nature. Something drove them to it. But if you don't believe people are basically good, you're far more likely to blame the criminals themselves, not outside forces, for their actions. One more example. In a society where it is believed that people are basically good, parents and society don't devote great efforts toward making good people. After all, if we're born good, why do you have to teach goodness? On the other hand, those who don't believe we are born all that good understand that parents and society have to undertake major efforts to make children into good adults. Okay, then, are people basically good? As I will show, given humanity's history, the answer should be obvious. Of course, human nature isn't basically good. Now, this doesn't mean that people are basically bad. We are born with real potential to do good, but we are not basically good. Take babies. Babies are lovable and innocent, but they're not good. They're entirely self-centered, as they have to be in order to survive. I want mommy, I want milk, I want to be held, I want to be comforted. And if you do not do all these things immediately, I will ruin your life. That's not goodness, that's narcissism. We are born narcissists, preoccupied with number one, ourselves. And if you've ever worked with kids, you know how cruel, how bullying they can be. And don't parents have to tell their child tens of thousands of times, say thank you? Now, why is that? If we're naturally good, wouldn't feeling and expressing gratitude come naturally? And then there is the historical record. Evils, huge evils affecting much of the human race, have been the norm. Here goes just a few examples. The Ottoman Turks targeted millions of Armenian Christians for death during World War I. The German Nazi regime murdered 6 million Jews, 2 out of every 3 European Jews, including more than 1 million children and babies. The Soviet communist regime slaughtered about 5 million Ukrainians and about 25 million other innocents. The Chinese communists killed about 70 million Chinese and enslaved the rest of the Chinese people. The North Korean communist regime has built what one can only call the world's largest concentration camp, most of North Korea. In post-colonial Congo, in the decade between 1998 and 2008, over 5 million people were murdered, and tens, if not hundreds of thousands of women raped. Of course, before that, about 10 million Africans were kidnapped and made slaves in the European slave trade. and another 10 to 18 million Africans were enslaved by Arab slave traders. And let me ask you this. If people are basically good, why does every civilization have so many laws to control human behavior? Knowing all this, those who believe that people are basically good have simply made a decision to believe that and ignore all the evidence. Why do people commit evil? Because it's easy to, because it's tempting to, and yes, because it often accords with human nature. That is why figuring out how to make good people is the single most important project in all of human life. But first, you have to believe it's necessary. I'm Dennis Prager.
Is it rational to believe in God? Many people think that faith and reason are opposites, that belief in God and tough-minded logical reasoning are like oil and water. They are wrong. Belief in God is far more rational than atheism. Logic can show that there is a God. If you look at the universe with common sense and an open mind, you'll find that it's full of God's fingerprints. A good place to start is with an argument by Thomas Aquinas, the great 13th century philosopher and theologian. The argument starts with the not very startling observation that things move, but nothing moves for no reason. Something must cause that movement. And whatever caused that must be caused by something else, and so on. But this causal chain cannot go backwards forever. It must have a beginning. There must be an unmoved mover to begin all the motion in the universe, a first domino to start the whole chain moving, since mere matter never moves itself. A modern objection to this argument is that some movements in quantum mechanics, radioactive decay, for example, have no discernible cause. But hang on a second. Just because scientists don't see a cause doesn't mean there isn't one. It just means science hasn't found it yet. Maybe someday they will. But then there will have to be a new cause to explain that one, and so on and so on. But science will never find the first cause. That's no knock on science. It simply means that a first cause lies outside the realm of science. Another way to explain this argument is that everything that begins must have a cause. Nothing can come from nothing. So if there's no first cause, there can't be second causes, or anything at all. In other words, if there's no creator, there can't be a universe. But what if the universe were infinitely old, you might ask? Well, all scientists today agree that the universe is not infinitely old, that it had a beginning in the Big Bang. If the universe had a beginning, then it didn't have to exist. And things which don't have to exist must have a cause. There's confirmation of this argument from Big Bang cosmology. We now know that all matter, that is, the whole universe, came into existence some 13.7 billion years ago, and it's been expanding and cooling ever since. No scientist doubts that anymore, even though, before it was scientifically proved, atheists called it creationism in disguise. Now, add to this premise a very logical second premise, the principle of causality, that nothing begins without an adequate cause. And you get the conclusion that since there was a Big Bang, there must be a Big Banger. But is this Big Banger God? Why couldn't it be just another universe? Because Einstein's general theory of relativity says that all time is relative to matter, and since all matter began 13.7 billion years ago, so did all time. So there's no time before the Big Bang. And even if there is time before the Big Bang, even if there is a multiverse, that is, many universes with many Big Bangs, as string theory says is mathematically possible, that too must have a beginning. An absolute beginning is what most people mean by God. Yet some atheists find the existence of an infinite number of other universes more rational than the existence of a creator, never mind that there is no empirical evidence at all that any of these unknown universes exists, let alone a thousand or a gazillion. The conclusion that God exists doesn't require faith. Atheism requires faith. It takes faith to believe in everything coming from nothing, It takes only reason to believe in everything coming from God. I'm Peter Kraft, professor of philosophy at Boston College for Prager University.
Anyone familiar with Italian opera or the plays of Shakespeare knows the terrible price paid for grudges, vendetta, and revenge. Under the sway of these emotions, painful incidents linger in the mind, sapping our ability to find peace and happiness. The 18th century English poet Alexander Pope gave us the antidote: to err is human, to forgive divine. But finding a way to forgive without giving up our principles is often no easy task. In this course, I'm going to address what forgiveness is and how to implement it. I'll be speaking here about forgiveness where it is most often needed, in the context of your everyday personal life with family members, friends, coworkers, and business associates. One of our challenges in understanding this process is that the word forgiveness is inadequate to explain a very complex concept. Forgiveness actually embodies three different things, each of which applies to different situations and provides different results. The three types of forgiveness are exoneration, forbearance, and release. Let's take each in turn. Exoneration is the closest to what we usually think of when we say forgiveness. Exoneration is wiping the slate entirely clean and restoring a relationship to the full state of innocence it had before the harmful actions took place. There are three common situations in which exoneration applies. The first takes place when you realize that the harmful action was a genuine accident for which no fault can be assigned. The second is when the offender is a child or someone else who, for whatever reason, simply didn't understand the hurt they were inflicting and toward whom you have loving feelings. The third situation occurs when the person who hurt you is truly sorry, takes full responsibility without excuses for what they did, asks forgiveness, and gives you confidence that they will not knowingly repeat their bad action in the future. In all such situations, it is essential to accept their apology and offer them the complete forgiveness of exoneration. You'll feel better, and so will the person who hurt you. In fact, not to offer forgiveness in these circumstances would be harmful to your own well-being. It might even suggest that there is something more wrong with you than with the person who caused you pain. The second type of forgiveness I call forbearance, and here things get a little more complicated. Forbearance applies when the offender makes a partial apology or mingles their expression of sorrow with blame that you somehow caused them to behave badly. An apology is offered, but it is not what you had hoped for and may not even be fully authentic. While you should always reflect on whether there was a provocation on your part, even when you bear no responsibility, you should exercise forbearance if the relationship matters to you. Cease dwelling on the particular offense, do away with grudges and fantasies of revenge, but retain a degree of watchfulness. This is similar to forgive but not forget, or trust but verify. By using forbearance, you are able to maintain ties to people who, while far from perfect, are still important to you. Furthermore, in some cases, after a sufficient period of good behavior, forbearance can rise to exoneration and full forgiveness. But what do you do when the person who hurt you doesn't even acknowledge that they've done anything wrong, or gives an obviously insincere apology, making no reparations whatsoever? These are the cases of forgiveness that are the most challenging. In my practice, I find this in such examples as adult survivors of child abuse, business people who've been cheated by their partners, or friends or relatives who've betrayed one another. Still, even here, there is a solution. I call it release, the third type of forgiveness. Release does not exonerate the offender, nor does it require forbearance. It doesn't even demand that you continue the relationship. But it does ask that instead of continuing to define your life in terms of the hurt done, you release your bad feelings and your preoccupation with the negative things that happened to you. Release does something that is critically important. It allows you to let go of the burden, the silent tax that is weighing you down and eating away at your chance for happiness. If you do not release the pain and anger and move past dwelling on old hurts and betrayals, you will be allowing the ones who hurt you to live rent-free in your mind reliving forever the persecution that the original incident started. Whether you get there through your own efforts, through psychotherapy, through religion, or some other method, release liberates you from the tyranny of living in the traumatic past, even when the other forms of forgiveness, exoneration and forbearance, are not possible. Exoneration, forbearance, release. To forgive may be divine, but when we understand its dimensions, we find that it is within our ability to do it. I'm Dr. Stephen Marmer of UCLA Medical School for Prager University.
Being a normal boy is a serious liability in today's classroom. Boys tend to be disorganized and restless. Some have even been known to be noisy and hard to manage. Sound like any boy you know? But increasingly, our schools have little patience for what only a couple of decades ago would have been described as boyishness. As psychologist Michael Thompson has aptly observed, girls' behavior is the gold standard in schools. Boys are treated like defective girls. Now, as a result, these defective girls are not faring well academically. Compared with girls, boys earn lower grades, they win fewer honors, they're far less likely to go to college. Boys are languishing academically while girls are prospering. In an ever more knowledge-based economy, this is not a recipe for a successful society. We need to start thinking about how we can make our grade school classrooms more boy-friendly. Well, here are four reforms that would make a very good start. One, turn boys into readers. In all age groups, across all ethnic lines, boys score lower than girls on national reading tests. Good reading skills, need I say, are critical to academic and workplace success. A major study in the UK discovered, not surprisingly, that girls prefer fiction, magazines, and poetry, while boys prefer comics and nonfiction. Boys whose eyes glaze over if forced to read Little House on the Prairie may be riveted by the Guinness Book of Records.
Cool.
Boys will read if given materials that interest them. If you're looking for suggestions for books that have proved irresistible to boys, go to guysread.com. Two, inspire the male imagination. Celebrated writing instructor Ralph Fletcher contends that too many teachers take what is called the confessional poet as the classroom ideal. Personal narratives full of emotions and self-disclosure, these are stories girls commonly write, and these are prized, whereas action stories describing, say, a skateboard competition or a monster devouring a city, these are not. I recently read about a third grader in Southern California named Justin, who loved science fiction, pirates, and battles. Well, an alarmed teacher summoned his parents to school to discuss the picture the 8-year-old had drawn of a sword fight, which included several decapitated heads. The teacher expressed grave concern about Justin's values. The boy's father was astonished, not by his son's drawing, which to him was typical boy stuff, but by the teacher's overwrought and female-centered reaction. If boys are constantly subject to disapproval for their interests and enthusiasms, they're likely to become disengaged and lag further behind. Our schools need to work with, not against, the kinetic imaginations of boys. Three, zero out, zero tolerance. Boys are nearly 5 times as likely to be expelled from preschool as girls. And in grades K through 12, boys account for nearly 70% of suspensions. Now, this is often for minor acts of insubordination and sometimes for entirely innocent behavior. Hardly a week goes by without a news story about a young boy running afoul of a school's zero tolerance policy. Josh Welsh, age 7, was recently sent home from his Maryland school for nibbling off the corners of a strawberry Pop-Tart into the shape of a gun. Josh, like many other boys punished for violating zero tolerance policies, was guilty of nothing more than being a typical 7-year-old boy. Four, bring back recess. Believe it or not, recess may soon be a thing of the past. According to research summarized by Science Daily, since the 1970s, school children have lost close to 50% of their unstructured outdoor playtime. And much-loved games have vanished from schoolyards. In schools throughout the country, games like dodgeball, Red Rover, even tag have all but disappeared. Too damaging to self-esteem or too violent being the usual excuse. One popular classroom guide suggests tug of war be replaced with tug of peace. Boys need to work off their energy. They need to be free to play games they enjoy. And keeping them cooped up and inside all day will not help them learn. As our schools become more feeling-centered, more competition-free, more sedentary, they move further away from the needs of boys. We need to reverse the boy-averse trends. Male underachievement is everyone's concern. These are our sons. These are the young men with whom our daughters will build a future. If boys are in trouble, so are we all. I'm Christina Hoff Summers, the American Enterprise Institute for Prager University.
I'm going to talk to you about the most important thing you will ever have. Now try to guess what that might be. For example, is it money? Well, it's certainly better to have money than not to, but it's definitely not the most important thing you can have. Just ask all the rich people who are very unhappy. Or even better, read about what's happened to most of the people who win tens of millions of dollars in a lottery. Most of these people actually became less happy, not more. So all right then, what about love? Is that the most important thing you can ever have? Well, love sure is important. I can't imagine living without it. I treasure the love of my friends and the love of my family. But if you don't have the thing I'm about to tell you, you won't receive much love at all. So let's try a third answer. Happiness. Well, that too is very, very important. Who wants to be unhappy? But again, without the thing I will tell you about, there would be little happiness in the world. So here goes. The most important thing you will ever have is, drum roll please, good values. Yes, good values. Now I know that may sound boring, and I realize that it's possible that you may have never really thought about values or even know what I'm talking about. So let me explain. A value is something you think is more important than anything else. More important than money, more important even than love, and even more important than happiness. And above all, values are what you consider to be more important than your feelings. This is very hard for a lot of people to believe because we live in a time when people think that how they feel about something is more important than anything else. But that isn't so. Here's a simple example of the conflict between a feeling and a value. Just about everyone feels like eating junk food. But there's a big problem here. If you eat whatever you feel like eating, you will end up obese and unhealthy. So then, what is it that stops people from eating all the food they feel like eating? The answer is a value. That's right, a value. And what is that value? Not getting obese and staying healthy. There is, in other words, a necessary battle that goes on inside of most people. The battle between what they feel, in this case, the desire to eat junk food, and a value that they hold, in this case, staying healthy and looking good. Now, as important as a healthy body is, this conflict between what we feel like doing and values is even more important when it comes to how we treat other people, not just ourselves. Here's one that will make you think. Imagine you're walking on a beach with the dog you love, when all of a sudden you look out at the water and you see your dog drowning. And imagine, too, that at the same time, about 100 feet from your dog, a person you don't know, a stranger, is also drowning. Now, which would you try to save first? Just about anyone who loves their pet would feel like saving their pet first. But what if you value human life even more than an animal's life? And you probably do. After all, you probably eat animals, but you wouldn't eat a human being. Then your value, the unique preciousness of human life, is in conflict with your feelings for your dog.
Here's another example. Imagine you are about to take an important test at school. If you cheat on that test, you'll be able to avoid failing and maybe even get into some great school. But what if you have a value, what we call a moral value, that cheating is wrong? You sure feel like cheating, but if you have moral values, you know it's wrong to. Again, that battle between your feelings and a value. Almost everything that is wrong with the world comes from people either not having higher moral values or not living by them because they feel they want to do something else. People who murder feel like murdering, and they do what they feel rather than live by the value of preserving human life. People who steal feel that they want the thing that they steal, so they take what they feel like having rather than live by the value of not stealing. The list is pretty much endless. And that's why good values are the most important thing any of us can ever have. Without them, the world would be a very terrible place. And finally, know this. The best people you know, meaning the nicest, kindest, and most honest, are people who battle their feelings every day of their lives. So should you. I'm Dennis Prager.
All good people are appalled by the sufferings of the innocent. When an innocent person is struck by a painful disease or tortured or murdered, we naturally feel sadness and helplessness and often rage. Many people have claimed that such suffering is a proof that God does not exist. Their argument goes like this. God is all good and all powerful. Such a God would not permit unnecessary suffering. Yet we constantly observe unjust suffering. Therefore, at least one of the premises about God must be false. Either God is not all good, or he is not all powerful, or he just doesn't exist. What's wrong with this argument? First, let's examine what we mean when we say that God would not permit unjust suffering. There are two categories of suffering. Suffering caused by human beings, which we call moral evils, and suffering caused by nature, for instance, earthquakes or cancer. Free will explains how God could be good and allow moral evil. Because God has given people free will, they are free to behave against God's will. The fact that they do evil does not prove that God is not good. In addition, if there were no God, there would be no absolute standard of good. Every judgment presupposes a standard. And then that's true of our moral judgments, too. What is our standard for judging evil to be evil? The most we could say about evil, if there were no God, was that we, in our subjective tastes, didn't like it when people did certain things to other people. We wouldn't have a basis for saying an act was bad, only that we didn't like it. So the problem of human evil exists only if God exists. As for natural suffering, that poses what appears to be a more difficult question. We see an innocent child suffer, say, from an incurable disease. We complain. Understandable. We don't like it. Understandable. We feel it is wrong, unfair, and shouldn't happen. Understandable. But illogical unless you believe in God. For if you do not believe in God, your subjective feelings are the only basis upon which you can object to natural suffering. Okay, you don't like it, but how is your not liking something evidence for God not existing? Think about it. It's just the opposite. Our judgments of good and evil, natural as well as human, presuppose God as the standard. If there's no God, there's neither good nor evil. There's just nature, doing what it does. If nature is all there is absolutely no need to explain why one person suffers and another doesn't. Unjust suffering is a problem only because we have a sense of what is just and unjust. But where does this sense come from? Certainly not from nature. There's nothing just about nature. Nature is only about survival. What, in other words, does it mean for suffering to be unnecessary or wrong? How is that determined? Against what standard? Your private standard means nothing. My private standard means nothing. We can talk meaningfully about suffering being unnecessary or wrong only if we have an underlying belief that a standard of right and wrong objectively exists. And if that standard really exists, that means there is a God. Moreover, the believer in God has an incomparably easier time than the atheist psychologically, as well as logically, in dealing with the problem of natural suffering. If you accept that a good God exists, it is possible to also believe that this God somehow sets things right, if not in this world, then in the next. For the atheist, on the other hand, no suffering is ever set right. There is no ultimate justice. The bad win and the good suffer. Earthquakes and cancers kill. End of story. Literally. If nature is all there is, how can a sensitive person remain sane in a world in which tsunamis wipe out whole towns, evil men torture and murder innocent victims, and disease attacks people indiscriminately? The answer is, it's not possible. Is that how you want to live? I'm Peter Kraft, professor of philosophy at Boston College for Prager University.
The right minimum wage, $0 and 0 cents. That was the headline of an editorial in one of America's most prestigious newspapers. Can you guess which one? The Wall Street Journal, perhaps. Right city, wrong paper. This editorial appeared in the New York Times in 1987. There's a virtual consensus among economists, the Times wrote, that the minimum wage is an idea whose time has passed. So economists and the liberal paper were on the same page, pun intended. Why? Because they understood that a minimum wage does not guarantee jobs. It guarantees only that those who get jobs will be paid at least that minimum. And that leads to two bad outcomes, unemployment and higher prices. I can best explain this by asking a simple question. What is a wage? A wage is the price of labor. Now, what happens if the price of labor rises not because workers have become more productive, not because a business must pay higher wages to hold on to valuable employees, but only because the government requires it? When the minimum wage rises, employers will adjust. They will use less labor. They'll fire current employees or cut back on their hours. They will also raise prices for their goods or services. These are undesirable consequences. But let's also consider another bad effect. Businesses will hire fewer workers, especially those with little or no job experience. Suppose you're young and haven't worked many jobs before. Maybe you've never had a job and are trying to land your first one. The work you can offer an employer may be worth only, say, $7 an hour. You agree?
Yes.
He agrees?
Yes.
And you have your first job. But what if the minimum wage set by the government is higher than $7? What if it's $10 or more? Well, you won't get the job. You may be willing to work for $7 an hour, but under minimum wage laws, it would be illegal for you to do so. This very point was made by Paul Samuelson, one of the leading economists of the 20th century and a prominent liberal. I paraphrase from his classic textbook, Economics. What good does it do a black youth to know that an employer must pay him a minimum wage if the fact that he must be paid that wage keeps him from getting a job? And that young person loses more than a paycheck. He also loses valuable work experience, learning to accept responsibility, dealing with a boss,
yeah,
getting along with coworkers,
yeah,
all the things that demonstrate to an employer that he made the right choice in hiring, and all the things that will help that young person get a better paying job down the road.
Yes!
A recent study found that in some cities, the unemployment rate for teens without a high school diploma approached 50%. Pricing these teens out of the labor market does them no favors. It's not doing the rest of society any favors either. Teenagers who can't find jobs often find trouble. Advocates of a higher minimum wage argue that while some young people might be priced out of the job market, this is outweighed by the fact that those who have minimum wage jobs will get a wage increase. But that doesn't mean they'd be better off. It's true that the government can force business owners to pay its minimum wage workers more per hour, but it can't force these business owners to pay them more per week. According to the Los Angeles Times, after Connecticut raised its minimum wage to $10.10 an hour, a 20-year-old woman who worked at a donut shop in Hartford was soon disappointed when her hours were cut from 35 per week to 27. Employers will look for other ways to cut costs. The Economic Policy Institute, a union-funded organization that pushes for higher minimum wages, admits this. Employers, they write on their website, may be able to absorb some of the costs of a wage increase through higher productivity, lower recruiting and training costs, decreased absenteeism, and increased worker morale. How would an employer get higher productivity? By working the employees harder. How would an employer cut training costs? By training them less. So let's summarize. Raising the minimum wage makes it harder for young and inexperienced workers to get jobs, to get on that crucial first rung of the employment ladder. And many of those who do benefit from a wage increase will likely find those benefits undone. They will work fewer hours, will work harder per hour, and will get less training. Sounds like the New York Times had it right back in 1987. I'm David Henderson, the editor of the Concise Encyclopedia of Economics for Prager University.
Which is the most persecuted religious group in the world today? The answer, in terms of sheer numbers and sheer horror, might surprise you. It's Christians, specifically Christians living in Muslim-majority countries, countries where Christians often preceded Muslims by centuries. I'm not talking about war on Christmas type harassment. I'm talking about know your place or we're going to kill you persecution. Astonishingly, the Western mainstream media barely acknowledge what is happening. Let's look closer at this issue. It tells us a lot about the world we're living in. 100 years ago, 20% of North Africa and the Middle East, the birthplace of Christianity, was Christian. Today, Christians make up 4% of the population. Much of that decline has occurred in the last decade. In essence, Muslims are rendering North Africa and the Middle East free of Christians. Take Egypt, for example, my ancestral homeland. In just the past 2 years, tens of thousands of Christian Copts have left Egypt. And many others want to leave, but they simply cannot afford to. Why they want to leave is no mystery. On New Year's Day, 2011, the Two Saints Church in Alexandria was bombed, leaving 23 Copts dead and 97 injured. In recent years, dozens of Coptic churches have been attacked, many burned to the ground. In August 2013 alone, the Muslim Brotherhood and its supporters attacked and destroyed some 80 churches. Unfortunately, Egypt is more the rule than the exception. Hundreds of Nigerian churches have been destroyed in recent years, with especially deadly attacks reserved for Christmas and Easter church services, leaving dozens dead or mutilated. Churches have been bombed or burned in Iraq, Syria, and just about every place in the Middle East where churches still exist, except Israel. Christian businesses have been torched, Christian girls have been kidnapped, sold as child brides or slaves, and had acid thrown in their faces for not being veiled. Anyone born a Muslim who converts to Christianity faces jail and possibly execution. The list of fresh atrocities by Muslims against Christians grows longer almost every day. Even in Muslim countries often portrayed as moderate, Morocco, Indonesia, Malaysia, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Christian minorities are under legal pressure not to build churches or evangelize. The Christians in these Muslim countries are often identical to their co-citizens in race, ethnicity, national identity, culture, and language. There is no political dispute between the Christians and Muslims, no land dispute. Vastly outnumbered and politically marginalized, these Christians simply wish to worship in peace. Instead, they are hounded and attacked. So then, why is this happening? And why is the media making so little mention of it? The first question is easy to answer. Christians are being persecuted in Muslim countries because they're Christians, or as the Quran puts it, infidels. That is, non-Muslims who are regarded by many fundamentalist Muslims as inferior. As a fundamentalist interpretation of the holy books of Islam has grown in the last 50 or so years, Christians have suffered, and in recent years they have suffered terribly. I document this in my book, Crucified Again, Exposing Islam's New War on Christians. If this were happening to any other group besides Christians, it would be the human rights tragedy of our time. There would be loud worldwide calls for action. But the silence in the mainstream Western media is, as they say, almost deafening. Why? Because Muslim persecution of Christians throws a wrench in the media's narrative that Muslim violence is a product of Muslim grievance. That grievance is, first and foremost, portrayed as the sin of European colonialism and alleged American imperialism. In the Muslim world's mind, those two sins are personified by the Jewish state of Israel, a nation the Muslim world believes was forced upon it by the colonial powers of Europe following World War II and is currently supported by the United States. Much of the Western world and the Western media have largely bought at least some of this narrative. Here's how it works. Because Israel, with the backing of the United States, is stronger than its Muslim neighbors, the media, while not defending Islamic terrorism, often portray terror against Israel, America, and even Europe as the actions of understandably angry underdogs fighting for what they deem justice. But what happens to this media narrative when Islamic terror is directed against a minority weaker than them? In this case, the millions of indigenous Christians throughout the Islamic world. The answer is that, rather than abandon this narrative, the media just don't report Muslim persecution of Christians, except for the most sensational cases. That's why you probably don't know that there are barely any Christians living in Algeria, Tunisia, and Libya, nations where Christianity once thrived, or that this is happening in Egypt, Iraq, Iran, and even Lebanon. So yes, Christians are indeed the most persecuted religious group in the world today. But reporting it would violate the media's narrative of Christians as persecutors and Muslims as victims. I'm Raymond Ibrahim, author of The Al-Qaeda Reader for PragerU University.
What is the first of the Ten Commandments? It might seem like an odd question, but it's not. Jews and Christians give different answers. The reason is that what we know as the Ten Commandments is, in the original Hebrew, the Ten Statements. And since the Hebrew is the original, we begin with the first statement, which all religions agree is, I am the Lord your God, who took you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. This statement is so important that none of the other commandments make sense without it. First, it asserts that God is giving these commandments, not Moses and not any other human being. Second, God is the one who delivered you from slavery. Again, no human being did this, not even Moses. Therefore, you have an obligation to me, God. And what is that obligation? That you live by the following nine commandments. This is the beginning of what is known as ethical monotheism, the greatest world-changing innovation of the Hebrew Bible. It means two things. Ethical monotheism means that the one God, that's monotheism, is the source of ethics, of morality. Morality, an objective code of right and wrong, does not emanate from human opinion. It emanates from God and therefore transcends human opinion. The other meaning of ethical monotheism is that what God most wants from us is that we treat other human beings morally. None of the Ten Commandments concern what humans must do, quote unquote, for God. Pre-Ten Commandments religions all believe that people must do a lot for their gods. For example, feed them and even sacrifice people to them. But now, thanks to the Ten Commandments, mankind learned that what God wants is that we be good to our fellow human beings. Even the commandments concerning not having false gods and not carrying God's name in vain are ultimately about morality. The thing we can do for God is to treat all his other children decently. Every parent can relate to this. Parents, or at least healthy parents, have indescribable joy when they see their children act lovingly toward one another, and indescribable pain when they see their children hurt one another. So too God, who is likened to our Father in heaven, cares most about how we treat other human beings, all of whom are his children. The third critical teaching of the first statement, I am the Lord your God who took you out of Egypt, out of the house of bondage, is the importance and the meaning of freedom. Note that God is not saying in this introduction to the Ten Commandments that he created the world. It surely would have made a lot of sense for God to introduce the Ten Commandments with the statement, I am the Lord your God who created the world. That is, after all, pretty impressive and would make sense. I created the world, you better listen to me. But no. The one thing God declares is that he took the children of Israel out of slavery and into freedom. That's how much God hates slavery and how important God considers freedom. The founders of America based their entire view of America on this belief that God wants us to be free. That is why the most iconic symbol of the American Revolution, the Liberty Bell, has only one sentence inscribed on it, a verse from the Hebrew Bible, proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto all the inhabitants thereof. But there is one other equally important lesson about freedom imparted by the opening statement of the Ten Commandments. What freedom means The giver of the Ten Commandments is in effect saying, I took you out of slavery and into freedom. And these Ten Commandments are the way to make a free society. You cannot be a free people if you do whatever you want. Freedom comes from moral self-control. There is no other way to achieve it. And fourth and finally, by telling us that he liberated the Hebrew slaves, God made clear that he cares deeply about human beings. It is impressive to create the world, but what most matters is not only that there is a creator, but that the creator cares about his creation. All of that is in the one statement with which the Ten Commandments begins. I'm Dennis Prager. Let's discuss the second commandment according to the oldest, that is the Jewish enumeration of the Ten Commandments. In Christian tradition, it's the first commandment. The most common translation begins, "You shall have no other gods before me." The commandment then goes on to prohibit both making idols and worshiping idols. Most people, when they think of this commandment, understandably think that it only prohibits the worship of idols and the worship of gods, such as the ancient pagan gods of rain, of fertility, all the other nature gods, and chief gods, such as the Roman Jupiter and the Greek Zeus. However, there is a major problem with this understanding of the commandment. Since no one today worships these gods, let alone worships idols made of stone, most people think that this commandment is irrelevant to modern life. The irony, however, is that this commandment is not only relevant to modern life, it is in many ways the mother of all the other commandments. Why is it so relevant today? Because today we have as many false gods as the ancients did. And why is it the mother of all the other commandments? Because if we identify false gods and avoid worshiping them, we will eliminate one of the greatest barriers to a good world, false gods. So let's begin by defining a false god. The point of biblical monotheism is that there is only one God, and that only this God, the creator of the universe, who demands that we keep these Ten Commandments, is to be worshipped. Why? First, because one God means one human race. Only if we all have the same creator or father, as it were, are we all brothers and sisters. Second, having the same parent also means that no person or group is intrinsically more valuable than any other. And third, one God means one moral standard for all people. If God declares murder wrong, it is wrong for everyone, and you can't go to another God for another moral standard. When anything else is worshipped, bad things result. Not only things that can obviously lead to evil, such as the worship of power, or race, or money, or flag, but also things that are almost always seen as quite beautiful, such as art, or education, or even love. Yes, any of these often wonderful things, when worshipped, can lead to terrible results. Take art. Many of the cruelest humans in history loved beautiful music and art. But as a music lover, I learned early in life the sad fact that great music can be used to inspire people to follow evil just as much as it can be used to inspire people to do good. The great Hollywood director Stanley Kubrick vividly made this point in his classic 1971 film, A Clockwork Orange. In it, men rape and murder while classical music plays in the background. Take education. We all recognize how important education can be, from preparing people to be able to find work to understanding the world. But education in and of itself, divorced from the higher ends of God and goodness, can lead, and often has led, to great evil. Many of the best educated people in Germany supported Hitler and the Nazis, and almost all of the Western world supporters of the genocidal regimes of Stalin in the Soviet Union and Mao in China were highly educated. There is nothing about a PhD that guarantees a person will be wiser, kinder, or more ethical than someone with only a high school education. The same holds true even of love. Love, of course, is so often beautiful, but it too can lead to evil. In the 20th century, people who put love of country above love of God and goodness often committed terrible evil. And here's a test for you. Imagine that the pet you love and a stranger, a person you don't know and therefore could not possibly love, are drowning. Do you first try to save your pet or the stranger? Well, if love is an end in itself, you save your pet. But if you hold human life as a higher value than love, you won't follow love. This commandment made the ethical revolution of the Bible and of the Ten Commandments, what is known as ethical monotheism, possible. Worship the God of the Ten Commandments, and you will make a good world. Worship a false god, no matter how noble sounding, and you will end up with a world of cruelty. I'm Dennis Prager. Is there such a thing as the worst sin, one sin that is worse than all the others? Well, there is. I am well aware that some people differ. They maintain that we can't declare any sin worse than any other. To God, a sin is a sin, is how it's often expressed. In this view, a person who steals a stapler from the office is committing as grievous a sin in God's eyes as a murderer. But most people, intuitively, as well as biblically, understand that some sins are clearly worse than others. We are confident that God has at least as much common sense as we do. The God of Judaism and Christianity does not equate stealing an office item with murder. So then, what is the worst sin? The worst sin is committing evil in God's name. How do we know? From the third commandment of the Ten Commandments. This is the only one of the Ten Commandments that states that God will not forgive a person who violates the commandment. What does the commandment say? It is most commonly translated as, "Do not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold guiltless," meaning will not forgive, "whoever takes his name in vain." Most people understandably think that the commandment forbids saying God's name for no good reason. So something like, "God, did I have a rough day at work today," violates the third commandment. But that interpretation presents a real problem. It would mean that whereas God could forgive the violation of any of the other commandments, dishonoring one's parents, stealing, adultery, or even committing murder, he would never forgive someone who said, "God, did I have a rough day at work today." Let's be honest. That would render God and the Ten Commandments morally incomprehensible. Well, as it happens, the commandment is not the problem. The problem is the translation. The Hebrew original does not say, "do not take." It says, "do not carry." The Hebrew literally reads, "do not carry the name of the Lord thy God in vain." One of the most widely used new translations of the Bible, the New International Version, or NIV, uses the word "misuse" rather than the word "take." You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. This is much closer to the original's intent. What does it mean to carry or to misuse God's name? It means committing evil in God's name, and that God will not forgive. Why not? When an irreligious person commits evil, it doesn't bring God and religion into disrepute. But when religious people commit evil, especially in God's name, they are not only committing evil, they are doing terrible damage to the name of God. In our time, there is an example of this. The evils committed by Islamists who torture, bomb, cut throats, and mass murder, all in the name of God, do terrible damage to the name of God. It is not coincidental that what is called the new atheism, the immense eruption of atheist activism, followed the 9/11 attacks on America by Islamist terrorists. In fact, the most frequent argument against God and religion concerns evil committed in God's name, whether it is done in the name of Allah today or was done in the past in the name of Christ. People who murder in the name of God not only kill their victims, they kill God too. That's why the greatest sin is religious evil. That's what the third commandment is there to teach. Don't carry God's name in vain. If you do, God won't forgive you. I'm Dennis Prager. Many people who revere the Ten Commandments don't think that the fourth is particularly important, let alone binding. Once you understand it, however, you will recognize how life-changing, even world-changing, the Sabbath commandment is, and you will begin to appreciate how relevant it is to your own life. The fourth commandment reads, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns." Why is this so important? First, perhaps more than any other commandment, it elevated the human being. How so? For nearly all of human history, life consisted overwhelmingly of work. In effect, humans were beasts of burden. This commandment, and only this commandment, changed all that by insisting that people cease working 1 day out of seven. Second, more than any other commandment, the Sabbath day reminds people that they are meant to be free. As the second version of the commandment, the one summarized by Moses in the book of Deuteronomy, states, "Remember that you were slaves in Egypt." In other words, remember that slaves cannot have a Sabbath. In light of this, I might add that in the biblical view, unless necessary for survival, people who choose to work 7 days a week are essentially slaves. Slaves to work, or perhaps to money, but slaves nonetheless. The millionaire who works 7 days a week is simply a rich slave. Third, while the Bible could not universally abolish slavery, the Sabbath commandment greatly humanized that terrible institution and even helped make slavery impossible. By definition, a slave owner was under no obligation to allow a slave to ever rest, let alone to rest 1 day every week. Yet that is exactly what the fourth commandment commanded. Even a slave has fundamental human rights. Therefore, a slave, too, is a human being. Fourth, the Sabbath almost single-handedly creates and strengthens family ties and friendships. When a person takes off from work 1 day every week, that day almost inevitably becomes a day spent with other people, namely family and or friends. It has similar positive effects on marriages. Ask anyone married to a workaholic how good it would be for their marriage if the workaholic would not work for 1 day each week. And you can appreciate the power of the Sabbath day. Fifth, the Sabbath commandment granted animals dignity. Even one's animals had to rest 1 day a week. It is, to the best of our knowledge, the first national law in history on behalf of animals. And its benefits to animals surely went beyond a mandatory day of rest for them. People who felt divinely obligated to give their animals a day of rest were much less likely to treat their animals cruelly any day of the week. Now, all five of these life-changing and society-changing benefits of the Sabbath are available to anyone. You don't have to be a Jew, a Christian, or even a believer in God to derive all these benefits. But the reality is that those who believe the Ten Commandments were given by God are the ones who have kept the Sabbath alive. The God factor plays another role in the Sabbath. Just as faith in God brings people to the Sabbath, observing the Sabbath brings people to faith in God. That is why the first version of the Ten Commandments, the version in the book of Exodus, ends with these words. For in 6 days God made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore God blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. However you interpret 6 days, and many Jewish and Christian believers do not translate days as 24-hour periods, the point is this. Every time you keep the Sabbath, you are affirming that there is a creator, that the world didn't just happen, that life isn't some meaningless coincidence, but that it is infinitely meaningful, and therefore each of us has a unique significance and purpose. Not bad for one day a week. No wonder that the Sabbath is one of the Ten Commandments. No wonder that those who have it in their lives are often happier, with richer family lives, more serenity, a community of friends, and yes, are even healthier. You might want to give it a try. I'm Dennis Prager. The fifth of the Ten Commandments reads, "Honor your father and your mother." This commandment is so important that it is one of the only commandments in the entire Bible that gives a reason for observing it, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. Many people read that part of the fifth commandment as a reward. But while it may be regarded as a reward, the fact remains that it is a reason. If you build a society in which children honor their parents, your society will long survive. And the corollary is, a society in which children do not honor their parents is doomed to self-destruction. In our time, this connection between honoring parents and maintaining civilization is not widely recognized. On the contrary, many of the best educated parents do not believe that their children need to show them honor, since honoring implies an authority figure. And that is a status many modern parents reject. In addition, many parents seek to be loved, not honored, by their children. Yet neither the Ten Commandments nor the Bible elsewhere commands us to love our parents. This is particularly striking, given that the Bible commands us to love our neighbor, to love God, and to love the stranger. The Bible understands that there will always be individuals who, for whatever reason, do not love a parent. Therefore, it does not demand what may be psychologically or emotionally impossible, but it does demand that we show honor to our parents. And it makes this demand only with regard to parents. There is no one else who the Bible commands us to honor. So then, why is honoring parents so important? Why does the Ten Commandments believe that society could not survive if this commandment were widely violated? One reason is that we as children need it. Parents may want to be honored, and they should want to be, but children need to honor parents. A father and a mother who are not honored are essentially adult peers of their children. They are not parents. No generation knows better than ours the terrible consequences of growing up without a father. Fatherless boys are far more likely to grow up and commit violent crime, mistreat women, and act out against society in every other way. Girls who do not have a father to honor, and hopefully to love as well, are more likely to seek the wrong men and to be promiscuous at an early age. Second, honoring parents is how nearly all of us come to recognize that there is a moral authority above us to whom we are morally accountable. And without this, we cannot create or maintain a moral society. Of course, for the Ten Commandments, the ultimate moral authority is God, who is therefore higher than even our parents. But it is very difficult to come to honor God without having had a parent, especially a father, to honor. Sigmund Freud, the father of psychiatry and an atheist, theorized that one's attitude towards one's father largely shaped one's attitude toward God. There's one more reason why honoring parents is fundamental to a good society. Honoring parents is the best antidote to totalitarianism. One of the first things totalitarian movements seek to do is to break the child-parent bond. A child's allegiance is shifted from parents to the state. Even in democratic societies, the larger the state becomes, the more it usurps the parental role. Finally, there are many ways to honor parents. The general rule is this: they get special treatment. Parents are unique, so they must be treated in a unique way. You don't talk to them in quite the same way you do anyone else. For example, you might use expletives when speaking to a friend, but you don't with a parent. You don't call them by their first name. And when you leave their home and make your own, you maintain contact with them. Having no contact with parents is the opposite of honoring them. And yes, we all recognize that some parents have behaved so cruelly, and I mean cruelly, not annoyingly, that one finds it morally impossible to honor them. There are such cases, but they are rare. And remember this: if your children see you honor your parents, no matter how difficult it may sometimes be, the chances are far greater that they will honor you. I'm Dennis Prager. You would think that of all the Ten Commandments, the one that needs the least explaining is the sixth, because it seems so clear. It is the one that the King James Bible, the most widely used English translation of the Bible, translates as, "Thou shalt not kill." Yet the truth is quite the opposite. This is probably the least well understood of the Ten Commandments. The reason is that the Hebrew original does not say, "Do not kill." It says, "Do not murder." Both Hebrew and English have two words for taking a life. One is kill, harag in Hebrew, and the other is murder, ratzach in Hebrew. The difference between the two is enormous. Kill means, one, taking any life, whether of a human being or an animal. Two, taking a human life, deliberately or by accident. Three, taking a human life, legally or illegally, morally or immorally. On the other hand, murder can only mean one thing: the illegal or immoral taking of a human life. That's why we say, "I killed a mosquito," not "I murdered a mosquito." And that's why we would say the worker was accidentally killed, not the worker was accidentally murdered. So why did the King James translation of the Bible use the word kill rather than murder? Because 400 years ago, when the translation was made, kill was synonymous with murder. As a result, some people don't realize that English has changed since 1610, and therefore think that the Ten Commandments prohibits all killing. But of course it doesn't. If the Ten Commandments forbade killing, we would all have to be vegetarians. Killing animals would be prohibited, and we would all have to be pacifists, since we could not kill even in self-defense. However, you don't have to know how the English language has evolved in order to understand that the Ten Commandments could not have prohibited all killing. The very same part of the Bible that contains the Ten Commandments, the five books of Moses, the Torah as it is known by Jews, commands the death penalty for murder, allows killing in war, prescribes animal sacrifice, and allows eating meat. A correct understanding of the commandment against murder is crucial, because while virtually every modern translation correctly translates the commandment as "do not murder," many people cite the King James translation to justify two positions that have no biblical basis: opposition to capital punishment and pacifism. Regarding capital punishment and the Bible, the only law that appears in each one of the five books of Moses is that murderers be put to death. Opponents of the death penalty are free to hold the view that all murderers should be allowed to live, but they are not free to cite the Bible to support their view. Yet many do, and they always cite the commandment, "Do not kill." But that, as should now be abundantly clear, is not what the commandment says, and it is therefore an invalid argument. As regards pacifism, the belief that it is always wrong to kill a human being, again, anyone is free to hold this position, as immoral as it may be. And what other word than immoral can one use to describe forbidding the killing of someone who was in the process of murdering innocent men, women, and children in, let's say, a movie theater or a school? But it is dishonest to cite the commandment against murder to justify pacifism. There is moral killing, most obviously when done in self-defense against an aggressor, and there is immoral killing. And the word for that is murder. The Ten Commandments are portrayed on two tablets. The Five Commandments on the second tablet all concern our treatment of fellow human beings. The first one on that list is do not murder. Why? Because murder is the worst act a person can commit. The other four commandments prohibiting stealing, adultery, giving false testimony, and coveting are all serious offenses. But murder leads the list, because deliberately taking the life of an innocent person is the most terrible thing we can do. The next time you hear someone cite do not kill when quoting the sixth commandment, gently but firmly explain that it actually says do not murder. I'm Dennis Prager. There's an old joke about the seventh commandment, do not commit adultery. Moses comes down from Mount Sinai and announces, I have good news and bad news. The good news is that I got him down to 10. The bad news is that adultery stays. The joke is telling. The prohibition on a married person having sexual relations with anyone except his or her spouse may be, for many people, the most consistently difficult of the Ten Commandments to observe. The reasons shouldn't be hard to guess. One is the enormous power of the sex drive. It can be very hard to keep in check for the entirety of one's marriage, especially when an attractive outsider makes him or herself sexually or romantically available. Another reason is the human desire to love and be loved. For normal people, there is no more powerful emotion than love. If one falls in love with someone while married, it takes great effort not to commit adultery with that person. And if we add in the unfortunate circumstance of a loveless marriage, adultery becomes even more difficult to resist. That's why the joke with which I began is funny, because it reflects truth. Why is adultery prohibited in the Ten Commandments? Because, like the other nine, it is indispensable to forming and maintaining higher civilization. Adultery threatens the very building block of the civilization that the Ten Commandments seeks to create. That building block is the family, a married father and mother and their children. Anything that threatens the family unit is prohibited in the Bible. Adultery is one example. Not honoring one's father and mother is another. And the prohibition on injecting any sexuality into the family unit, incest, is a third example. Why is the family so important? Because without it, social stability is impossible. Because without it, the passing on of society's values from generation to generation is impossible. Because commitment to a wife and children makes men more responsible and mature. Because more than anything else, family meets most women's deepest emotional and material needs. And nothing comes close to the family in giving children a secure and stable childhood. And why does adultery threaten the family? The most obvious reason is that sex with someone other than one spouse can all too easily lead to either or both spouses leaving the marriage. Adultery should not automatically lead to divorce, but it often does. There is another reason adultery can destroy a family. It can lead to pregnancy and then to the birth of a child. That child will, in almost all cases, start out life with no family, meaning no father and mother married to each other to call his or her own. And if adultery doesn't destroy a family, it almost always does terrible harm to a marriage. Aside from the sense of betrayal and loss of trust that it causes, it means that the adulterous partner lives a fraudulent life, When a husband or wife is having sex with someone other than their spouse, their thoughts are constantly about that other person and about how to deceive their spouse. The life of deception that an adulterous affair necessarily entails inevitably damages a marriage, even if the betrayed spouse is unaware of the affair. Finally, the commandment prohibiting adultery doesn't come with an asterisk saying that adultery is okay if both spouses agree to it. Spouses who have extramarital sex with the permission of their husband or wife may not necessarily be hurting their spouse's feelings, but they are still harming the institution of marriage. And protecting the family, not protecting spouses from emotional pain, is the reason for the commandment. Many marriages, sadly, are troubled, and it is not for any of us to stand in judgment of others' behavior in this realm. No one knows what goes on in anyone else's marriage, and if we did, we might often well understand why one or the other sought love outside the marriage. But no higher civilization can be made or can endure that condones adultery. That is why it is prohibited in the Ten Commandments. I'm Dennis Prager. A good case can be made that the Eighth Commandment, do not steal, is the one commandment that encompasses all the others. How does do not steal encompass the other commandments? Well, murder is the stealing of another person's life. Adultery is the stealing of another person's spouse. Coveting is the desire to steal what belongs to another person. Giving false testimony is stealing justice, and so on. This commandment is unique in another way. It is the only commandment that is completely open-ended. All the other commandments are specific. The fifth commandment, for example, states that it is our parents whom we should honor. The sixth commandment, prohibiting murder, is about taking the life of an innocent human being. The seventh commandment, prohibiting adultery, is also specific to a married person. Two unmarried people cannot commit adultery. But the commandment against stealing doesn't even hint at what it is we're forbidden to steal, which means that we cannot take anything that belongs to another person. And that, in turn, means three big things. First and foremost, the commandment against stealing has always been understood to mean that we are not allowed to steal another human being, what we call kidnapping. That is why no one who had even an elementary understanding of the Eighth Commandment could ever use the Bible to justify the most common form of slavery, the kidnapping of human beings and selling them into slavery. Critics of the Bible argue that the Bible allowed slavery, but the type of slavery described was in almost all cases what was known as indentured servitude, the selling of oneself to another person for a fixed period of time in order to work off a debt. This had nothing to do with kidnapping free people, such as was done in Africa and elsewhere. That was expressly forbidden by the Eighth Commandment. The second significant meaning of the commandment against stealing is the sanctity of people's property. Just as we are forbidden to steal people, we are forbidden to steal what people own. It has been shown over and over that private property, beginning with land ownership, is indispensable to creating a free and decent society. Every totalitarian regime takes away private property rights. In the ancient and medieval world, a few rich people owned all the land, and the majority of the population worked on that land for the enrichment of the owners. And then, in 19th century Europe, many socialists argued for taking away private property and giving it to the quote-unquote people. Where that advice was followed, in what came to be known as the communist world, theft of property quickly resulted in theft of freedom and ultimately massive theft of life. The third enormously important meaning of the commandment against stealing concerns the many non-material things each person owns: their reputation, their dignity, their trust, and their intellectual property. Let's quickly run through these. One, a person's reputation. Stealing a person's good name, whether through libel, slander, or gossip, is a particularly destructive form of theft. Because, unlike money or property, once a person's good name has been stolen, it can almost never be fully restored. 2. A person's dignity. The act of stealing a person's dignity is known as humiliation. And humiliating a person, especially in public, can do permanent damage to what is perhaps the most precious thing any of us owns, our dignity. 3. A person's trust. Stealing a person's trust is known as deceiving someone. In fact, in Hebrew, a term for tricking someone is gnevat da'at, which literally means stealing knowledge. One example is tricking people into buying something, as when a real estate agent omits telling a prospective purchaser all the flaws in a home in order to make a sale. Another example would be when someone deceives another person with insincere proclamations of love in order to obtain material or sexual favors. 4. A person's intellectual property. This form of theft includes anything from copying software or downloading music and movies without paying for them, to stealing a person's words, what we know as plagiarism. Stealing a life, a person, a spouse, material property, intellectual property, a reputation, dignity, or trust. There is hardly any aspect of human life that is not harmed, sometimes irreparably so, by stealing. That is why it is fair to say that if everyone observed only one of the Ten Commandments, observing the commandment, do not steal, would, all by itself, make a beautiful world. I'm Dennis Prager. The ninth of the Ten Commandments is, you shall not give false witness against your neighbor. This means two things: do not lie when testifying in court, and do not lie, period. Remember, in order for an action to be prohibited or demanded in the Ten Commandments, it has to be fundamental to making civilization. As important as donkey riding might have been when the Ten Commandments were given, the Ten Commandments contains no commandment to ride your donkey responsibly. A society can survive bad donkey drivers, but it cannot survive contempt for truth, whether inside or outside a courtroom. If people testify falsely in a courtroom, there can be no justice, and without even the hope of justice, there can be no civilization. The Hebrew Bible was so adamant on this subject that the punishment imposed on a witness who gave false testimony was the same as the punishment that would have been meted out to the accused had the false testimony been believed. In the case of a crime that would be punishable by death, therefore, the false witness was liable to be put to death. But the commandment is clearly concerned with truth generally, not only in a courtroom. Both the great 12th century Jewish commentator Ibn Ezra and one of the most influential biblical scholars of the 20th century, Brevard Childs of Yale University, agreed that the commandment was about truth-telling generally. As Childs pointed out, if the Ten Commandments were solely concerned with truth and falsehood in a courtroom, it would have added words such as, in court. There are many important values in society, but truth is probably the most important. Goodness and compassion may be the most important values in the micro or personal realm, but in the macro or societal realm, truth is even more important than compassion or kindness. Virtually all the great societal evils, such as African slavery, Nazism, and communism, have been based on lies. There were slave traders, Nazis, and communists who were compassionate in their personal lives. But all of them told, and most of them believed, some great lie that enabled them to participate in a great evil. Black slavery was made possible in large measure by the lie that blacks were innately inferior to whites. The Holocaust would have been impossible without tens of millions of people believing the lie that Jews were inherently inferior to so-called Aryans. And communist totalitarianism was entirely based on lies. That's why the Soviet Union's Communist Party newspaper was named Pravda, the Russian word for truth, because the party, not objective reality, was the source of truth. There's only so much evil that can be done by individual sadists and sociopaths. In order to murder millions, vast numbers of otherwise normal, even decent people must believe lies. Mass evil is committed not because a vast number of people seek to be cruel, but because they are fed lies that convince them that what is evil is actually good. However, one big obstacle to truth-telling is that believers in causes, including good causes, that don't place truth as a central value, will be very tempted to lie on behalf of their cause. There are many examples. In the 1980s, for example, to promote the cause of the homeless, the leading activist on their behalf claimed that there were 2 to 3 million homeless in the United States. Years later, he admitted on national television that he had to come up with a number and made that one up. The real number was between 250,000 and 350,000. Similarly, groups in the fight against cancer were caught greatly exaggerating the number of women who get breast cancer each year. Why? In order to frighten more women into getting mammograms. Again, lying on behalf of a good cause. Why is lying on behalf of good causes destructive? Because if we don't know what's true, how and where do we know how to properly allocate society's limited resources? And in the worst cases, it distorts society's priorities and therefore does great harm. The Ten Commandments is there to warn all of us that with very few exceptions, such as the immediate saving of innocent life, no cause is more important than truth-telling. The Ten Commandments is the greatest list of instructions ever devised for creating a good society, but such a society cannot be created or maintained if it is not based on truth. I'm Dennis Prager. In the Ten Commandments, Commandments 6, 7, 8, and 9 are the ones that prohibit acts of evil, murder, adultery, stealing, and perjury. And then there is one commandment that prohibits the thing that leads to murder, adultery, stealing, and perjury. Which one is it? It's the last of the ten. Do not covet anything that belongs to others. Not their spouse, their house, their servants, their animals, or any of their property. In order to understand this commandment and its unique significance, the first thing to understand is that this is the only one of the Ten Commandments that legislates thought. All the other commandments legislate behavior. In fact, of the 613 laws in the 5 books of Moses, virtually none prohibit thought. Why then does the Ten Commandments include a law that prohibits a thought? Because it is coveting that so often leads to evil. Or, to put it another way, coveting is what leads to violating the preceding 4 commandments, the ones against murder, adultery, stealing, and perjury. Think about it. Why do people do those things? In most instances, it's because they covet something that belongs to another person. Obviously, that is the reason people steal. Thieves covet their victim's property. But it is also the reason for many murders, and coveting is obviously the reason for adultery, wanting the spouse of another person. As for perjury, or bearing false witness in the language of the Ten Commandments, that is done in order to cover up all these other crimes that are caused by coveting. But in order to understand why coveting is the one thought that is prohibited in the Ten Commandments, and one of the only thoughts prohibited in the entire Hebrew Bible, we need to understand what coveting means, and equally important, what it doesn't mean. To covet is much more than to want. The Hebrew verb, lachmod, means to want to the point of seeking to take away and own something that belongs to another person. Note that there are two operative elements here, seeking to own and belongs to another person. Seeking to own does not mean just envying, or in the case of your neighbor's spouse, just lusting after. Neither envy nor lust is prohibited in the Ten Commandments. Uncontrolled envy and lust can surely lead to bad things, and they can both be psychologically and emotionally destructive. But neither one is prohibited in the Ten Commandments. Why? Because neither is the same as coveting. It is coveting that almost inevitably leads to stealing, to adultery, and sometimes even to murder. Let me explain this in another way. The Tenth Commandment does not prohibit you from saying, "Wow, what a great house or car or spouse my neighbor has. I wish I had such a house or car or spouse." That may end up being destructive, but it may also end up being constructive. How? It may spur you to work harder and improve your life so that you can obtain a house or car or spouse like your neighbor's. It is when you want and seek to gain possession of the specific house, car, or spouse that belongs to another that evil ensues, and that is what the Tenth Commandment prohibits. Therefore, one of these Ten Commandments, these 10 basic rules of life, must be that we simply cannot allow ourselves to covet what belongs to our neighbor. Whatever belongs to another person must be regarded as sacrosanct. We cannot seek to own anything that belongs to another, because only evil can come of it. I'm Dennis Prager.
In 1966, Time magazine ran a cover story asking, "Is God dead?" The cover reflected the fact that many people had accepted the cultural narrative that God is obsolete, that as science progresses, there's less need for a God to explain the universe. It turns out, though, that the rumors of God's death were premature. In fact, perhaps the best arguments for his existence come from, of all places, science itself. Here's the story. The same year Time featured its now famous headline, the astronomer Carl Sagan announced that there were two necessary criteria for a planet to support life: the right kind of star, and a planet the right distance from that star. Given the roughly octillion planets in the universe, that's one followed by 24 zeros, there should have been about septillion planets, that's one followed by 21 zeros, capable of supporting life. With such spectacular odds, scientists were optimistic that the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, known by its initials SETI, an ambitious project launched in the 1960s, was sure to turn up something soon. With a vast radio telescopic network, scientists listened for signals that resembled coded intelligence. But as the years passed, the silence from the universe was deafening. As of 2014, researchers have discovered precisely bupkis, nada, zilch, which is to say zero, followed by an infinite number of zeros. What happened? As our knowledge of the universe increased, it became clear that there were, in fact, far more factors necessary for life, let alone intelligent life, than Sagan supposed. His two parameters grew to 10, then 20, and then 50, which meant that the number of potentially life-supporting planets decreased accordingly. The number dropped to a few thousand planets and kept on plummeting. Even SETI proponents acknowledged the problem. Peter Schenkel wrote in a 2006 piece for Skeptical Inquirer, a magazine that strongly affirms atheism, "In light of new findings and insights, we should quietly admit that the early estimates may no longer be tenable." Today, there are more than 200 known parameters necessary for a planet to support life, every single one of which must be perfectly met or the whole thing falls apart. For example, without a massive gravity-rich planet like Jupiter nearby to draw away asteroids, Earth would be more like an interstellar dartboard than the verdant orb that it is. Simply put, the odds against life in the universe are astonishing. Yet, here we are, not only existing, but talking about existing. What can account for it? Can every one of those many parameters have been perfectly met by accident? At what point is it fair to admit that it is science itself that suggests that we cannot be the result of random forces? Doesn't assuming that an intelligence created these perfect conditions in fact require far less faith than believing that a life-sustaining Earth just happened to beat the inconceivable odds? But wait, there's more. The fine-tuning necessary for life to exist on a planet is nothing compared with the fine-tuning required for the universe to exist at all. For example, astrophysicists now know that the values of the four fundamental forces, gravity, the electromagnetic force, and the strong and weak nuclear forces, were determined less than 1/1,000,000th of a second after the Big Bang. Alter any one of these four values ever so slightly, and the universe as we know it could not exist. For instance, if the ratio between the strong nuclear force and the electromagnetic force had been off by the tiniest fraction of the tiniest inconceivable fraction, then no stars could have formed at all. Multiply that single parameter by all the other necessary conditions, and the odds against the universe existing are so heart-stoppingly astronomical that the notion that it all just happened defies common sense. It would be like tossing a coin and having it come up heads 10 quintillion times in a row. I don't think so. Fred Hoyle, the astronomer who coined the term Big Bang, said that his atheism was greatly shaken by these developments. One of the world's most renowned theoretical physicists, Paul Davies, has said that the appearance of design is overwhelming. Even the late Christopher Hitchens, one of atheism's most aggressive proponents, conceded that without question the fine-tuning argument was the most powerful argument of the other side. Oxford University professor of mathematics, Dr. John Lennox, has said, "The more we get to know about our universe, the more the hypothesis that there is a creator gains in credibility as the best explanation of why we are here." The greatest miracle of all time is the universe. It is the miracle of all miracles, one that inescapably points to something or someone beyond itself. I'm Eric Metaxas for Prager University.
Here's a question you're likely to hear whenever the subject of taxes comes up. Do the rich pay their fair share? There are two parts to this question: who is rich and what is fair. Let's start with who is rich. Nearly everyone assumes that a person who is among the top 10% of all income earners qualifies as rich. But according to 2011 data, a top 10% household makes around $150,000 or above in gross annual income. That's income before deductions and taxes. Now, $150,000 is a nice living, but it certainly doesn't make you rich. Okay then, what about the top 5%? You get into this percentile if your household makes around $190,000 or above. That's a nice bump, but it hardly puts you in the rich category. How about the top 1%? That's $500,000 or above. A great income. But remember, most people only get to that level after many years of hard work and quite possibly the accumulation of serious debt to fund their education or build their business. Of course, there are people who make more than $500,000, and there are some who make many millions, even billions, but the number who do is very small. Now let's talk about fair. Fair would seem to be that the group of taxpayers who earn 10% of the country's income would pay 10% of the country's taxes. The group who earned 20% would pay 20% of the taxes, and so on. But what if I told you that according to IRS data, the top 10% of all earners, the people making $150,000 and above, pay 71% of all federal income tax while earning only 43% of all income? If anything, the top 10% pay more than their fair share. So, as it happens, do the much-reviled top 1%. They earn 17% of all income, but pay 37% of all federal income taxes. And what about those at the other end of the income scale, the lower earners? Are we squeezing them? Hardly. Those who make $45,000 or less, 47% of all earners pay little and often no income taxes. Ah, but what about payroll taxes, the money we pay to fund Social Security and Medicare? That takes a bigger bite of the paycheck of lower earners than higher earners. Isn't that unfair? Consider two points. First, it's misleading to call the payroll tax a tax. It's really an insurance payment that guarantees we receive Social Security and Medicare after we turn 65. Second, the benefits we receive from Social Security are capped, no matter how much we have paid in. This means that the payroll taxes of high earners actually help subsidize the Social Security and Medicare benefits that low earners receive at retirement. How do all these numbers stack up against other countries? The U.S. income tax system is substantially more progressive, meaning that income tax rates rise as income rises, than other advanced countries, including Germany and Sweden. So if you think that our tax system is unfair because it coddles high earners, then you must conclude that tax systems in these other countries are even more unfair. So how high are tax rates on Americans today? Well, throw in federal tax increases mandated in 2013, and state taxes, and top earners face a tax rate of more than 50% in California and New York. Other states like Maryland and Connecticut are not far behind. Do you think a tax rate of greater than 50% is fair? If so, is there any rate that wouldn't be? Nobody's calling for bake sales for anyone in the top 10% of earners, and no one wants to minimize the struggles of those at the lower income strata. But to say the rich, however you might define them, don't pay their fair share is simply wrong. Finally, numerous academic studies, including ones that I have done, show that when tax rates are too high, investment, risk-taking by entrepreneurs, and therefore job creation all decline. And when that happens, it's the poor who suffer, not the rich. The rich do fine. It may feel good to take even more money from the top 10%, but it doesn't do good, and it sure isn't fair. I'm Lee Ohanian, professor of economics at UCLA for Prager University.
In the external or physical world, we're all aware of standard cause and effect, right? You know, object A acts upon object B with force X. We all get that because it applies to just about everything from electrons to athletes. But now consider events in your internal or mental world. What causes your thoughts? Some of our thoughts have external causes, like when we touch something and suddenly realize it's hot. We don't deliberate whether or not to pull our hand away, right? Our brain has already fired the instruction to do so, involuntarily. In some strange sense, we didn't really pull our hand away at all because we didn't choose to do it. Our brain did it before consulting us. A second cause of our thoughts is internal. Say you're thinking about giving a big presentation, and as you do so, you get increasingly nervous and your blood pressure and your heart rate jump up. Now, nothing external is acting upon you. You're doing all the causing internally, right? Your anxious thoughts are causing your brain to send signals to your heart, and we get that. But now I want you to consider a third category of your thoughts. It's your conscious choices. Something as simple as choosing where to go for lunch. Now, when you introspect, when you think about your thinking, do you believe that you're the active agent in charge of the process, or that you're just a passive recipient of the instruction, that you have no choice in the matter? It's all external forces, be they environmental, genetic, chemical, biological, or neurological. In other words, do you think all your thoughts have external causes beyond your control, or do you think that you control some, if not most, of your thoughts? Now, let's stay with our lunch example for a second. Back to the question. I ask you, where do you want to go for lunch today? Now, if all you are is a brain, an exhaustively physical system of neurons and synapses, then there's no you that's going to be making a choice at all. Your thought processes are basically just a complex series of colliding electron dominoes crashing into one another. It's just physical cause and effect, right? Something that can be exhaustively understood in terms of physics and chemistry. There's no you that's an agent that's deliberating or choosing or exercising free will. And that's why, if you are just a brain, you cannot have free will. You would just be a physical machine, a very complex but programmed computer. But if you're something more than your brain, if you're the thing that has the brain, then when I ask you, where do you want to go for lunch? You're going to start deliberating. You're going to be weighing your taste preferences, the commute time, perhaps even counting calories. You'd be weighing various reasons to choose one place over another. You wouldn't be caused to think about any of these things. You would choose to think about these things, and you could stop anytime you wanted to. So what we have here, therefore, are two different types of things, an immaterial mind and the material brain. You are the thing that has the brain. You are not your brain. Now look, even if you were the world's foremost brain expert and you knew what was happening with every electron in someone's brain at a specific particular moment, you still wouldn't have a clue about what's going on inside that person's mind. Surgeons can have access to my brain, but only I have access to my mind. This is what makes you human and not a machine. Psychology, the study of the mind, is not reducible to physics and biology and chemistry. Yet, there are many materialists, people who believe that physical matter is all that exists, that the only reality, including every thought, every feeling, every mind, every will, all of this, is totally explained in terms of matter in motion, simply physical phenomena. These materialists believe that we're no more than robots and that free will is an illusion, a myth. Now, why do they believe this? Because they understand that the moment they acknowledge that free will exists, that there really is an immaterial you beyond the physical realm, that there really is a mind, not just a brain, then there has to be something non-physical that accounts for our non-physical minds. Now, when you exercise your free will and you choose to think about all of this, you're going to probably reason, just like I did, that there's a great mind that accounts for the origin of your mind. But again, that's your choice. It's evidence of your free will. I'm Frank Pastore for Prager University.
What's profit? And why is it so important to everyone, not just business owners and entrepreneurs? Here's a simple quiz. When you spend $100 on a new pair of shoes, does the shop owner get to keep that $100? The answer, of course, is no. The shop owner has to pay all of his business costs, employee salaries, inventory, rent, supplies, taxes, and a dozen other expenses. His profit is what's left over. It's his payment for the time and money he spent and the risks that he's taken to keep his business going. Thank goodness for profits. Profits motivate people to work hard for themselves and make life better for others. Take the example of Bill Gates. How did he become so wealthy? The answer is that he came up with something that millions of people so wanted and needed that they reached into their pockets to pay for it. His Windows operating system, Word software, and other Microsoft products. What's more, he produced these products in a way that efficiently used resources. And what motivated him and just about every other successful entrepreneur to work so hard? The answer is profits. Without the incentive of profits, why would anyone spend his savings, work countless hours, and take all the risks necessary to bring their product or service to the marketplace? There's a simple answer. They wouldn't. You don't have to make billions like Bill Gates. Take a Montana cattle rancher who goes out in the dead of winter, even in blizzards, to feed his cows, to keep them safe and care for them, making huge personal sacrifices so that New Yorkers can sit down to eat a nice steak. Why does the rancher do that? Do you think he does it because he loves New Yorkers? Of course not. The rancher tends to his cattle because he wants more for himself and his family. He wants profits. You can go to a supermarket any day of the week, and if you want steak, they have it. If you want potatoes, they have them. Sugar, salt, potato chips, strawberries, peanut butter, they have it. In fact, the average well-stocked supermarket in the United States has over 50,000 different items on its shelves. How does all that get there? It seems like magic, but it's not. Every one of those items is on the shelves thanks to one thing, profit. The same holds true for the device you're watching this video course on. Whether it's a TV, a desktop or laptop computer, a smartphone, or a tablet. And for every component in those devices, they all exist as millions of other products we treasure and depend upon exist because of the profit motive. No profit, and it all goes away. Here's another reason the profit motive is so important. Ask yourself this question. Which establishments do you tend to be most dissatisfied with? The answer is likely to be government agencies. Why? Because they don't operate for profit. So no one is rewarded for good work, and almost no one is ever punished for inferior work. And which establishments are you most satisfied with? The answer is likely to be the ones that operate on a for-profit basis. If I'm unhappy with, say, a department store like Macy's or Bloomingdale's because it's not providing me with the goods or services that I want, I can, in essence, fire that store by taking my business elsewhere. But consider a government agency like Department of Motor Vehicles or public schools. If I'm frustrated with their performance, I can't fire them because I don't have many alternatives. Business owners must please their customers or risk failure and bankruptcy. Government agencies risk nothing and therefore have to please no one. Am I saying we don't need government? That everything should be on a for-profit basis? Of course not. But what I am saying is that we should want as little government as possible. That's exactly what the founding fathers of our nation believed. They understood that the profit motive pushes people to do extraordinary things. Take that motivation away, and the world becomes a very different and darker place. I'm Walter Williams of George Mason University for Prager University.
I want to talk to you about the Electoral College and why it matters. All right, I know this doesn't sound like the most sensational topic of the day, but stay with me because I promise you it's one of the most important. To explain why requires a very brief civics review. The President and Vice President of the United States are not chosen by a nationwide popular vote of the American people. Rather, they are chosen by 538 electors. This process is spelled out in the United States Constitution. Why didn't the founders just make it easy and let the presidential candidate with the most votes claim victory? Why did they create, and why do we continue to need, this Electoral College? The answer is critical to understanding not only the Electoral College, but also America. The founders had no intention of creating a pure majority rule democracy. They knew from careful study of history what most have forgotten today or never learned. Pure democracies do not work. They implode. Democracy has been colorfully described as two wolves and a lamb voting on what's for dinner. In a pure democracy, bare majorities can easily tyrannize the rest of a country. The founders wanted to avoid this at all costs. This is why we have three branches of government: executive, legislative, and judicial. It's why each state has two senators, no matter what its population, but also different numbers of representatives based entirely on population. It's why it takes a supermajority in Congress and three-quarters of the states to change the Constitution. And it's why we have the Electoral College. Here's how the Electoral College works. The presidential election happens in two phases. The first phase is purely democratic. We hold 51 popular elections every presidential election year, one in each state and one in D.C. On Election Day in 2012, you may have thought you were voting for Barack Obama or Mitt Romney, but you were really voting for a slate of presidential electors. In Rhode Island, for example, if you voted for Barack Obama, you voted for the state's four Democratic electors. If you voted for Mitt Romney, you were really voting for the state's four Republican electors. Part two of the election is held in December, and it is this December election among the state's 538 electors, not the November election, which officially determines the identity of the next president. At least 270 votes are needed to win. Why is this so important? Because the system encourages coalition building and national campaigning. In order to win, a candidate must have the support of many different types of voters from various parts of the country. Winning only the South or the Midwest is not good enough. You cannot win 270 electoral votes if only one part of the country is supporting you. But if winning were only about getting the most votes, a candidate might concentrate all of his efforts in the biggest cities or the biggest states. Why would that candidate care about what people in West Virginia or Iowa or Montana think? But, you might ask, isn't the election really only about the so-called swing states? Actually, no. If nothing else, safe and swing states are constantly changing. California voted safely Republican as recently as 1988. Texas used to vote Democrat. Neither New Hampshire nor Virginia used to be swing states. Most people think that George W. Bush won the 2000 election because of Florida. Well, sort of. But he really won the election because he managed to flip one state which the Democrats thought was safe, West Virginia. Its four electoral votes turned out to be decisive. No political party can ignore any state for too long without suffering the consequences. Every state, and therefore every voter in every state, is important. The Electoral College also makes it harder to steal elections. Votes must be stolen in the right state in order to change the outcome of the Electoral College. With so many swing states, this is hard to predict and hard to do. But without the Electoral College, any vote stolen in any precinct in the country could affect the national outcome, even if that vote was easily stolen in the bluest California precinct or the reddest Texas one. The Electoral College is an ingenious method of selecting a president for a great, diverse republic such as our own. It protects against the tyranny of the majority, encourages coalition building, and discourages voter fraud. Our founders were proud of it. We can be too. I'm Tara Ross for Prager University.
G'day there. As an outsider, I have a unique perspective from which to view America. As an American friend said to me, sometimes it takes someone on the outside to remind us what we're like on the inside. I'm an Australian, you might have already guessed that, and I love my home country, and I am proud that my nation has long been a reliable American ally. But I know that Australia is not America, and that my country has not achieved what America has achieved. No country in human history has. What makes America different? There are many answers, but start with one you might not have thought of. Most people think America is all about success. I see it a little differently. I think America is all about failing. Most people in the world don't get the chance to fail. But Americans take it for granted. Only Americans say, if at first you don't succeed, try, try again. There's even an academic study to prove this. According to a study by Harvard Business School professor Stephen Rogers, most entrepreneurs fail four times before they succeed. Success takes timing and hard work, some good luck, many other factors. But to succeed, you must be given the chance to fail, and you must accept responsibility if you do. I love that about Americans. At their best, they don't blame others. They learn from their mistakes and do better the next time. And in America, there's almost always a next time. Nowhere else are you as free to take entrepreneurial risks. Talk to someone who has tried to start a small business in Germany or Brazil, and you'll see what I mean. From the outside looking in, I can only admire this. And I'm not the only one. Just take a look at the CEOs of major Silicon Valley companies. You will see the names of entrepreneurs from all over the world, India, Pakistan, Russia, Israel, you name the country. Why did they come to America to innovate? Because there's a lot of money here? Yes, of course, that's part of it. But there's a lot of money in London and Berlin and Tokyo as well. They came to America because America gave them the chance to fail, and therefore the best chance in the world to succeed. And the rest of the world can thank their lucky stars for America's economic success. Not only is America by far the world's largest economy, it is also the world's largest consumer. And the world's economy depends on being able to sell to America. It would also be perfectly natural for Americans to want to keep all this wealth to themselves, but they don't. Just the opposite, in fact. America has been the most selfless nation in the history of the world. Yet another way in which America is different. What other nation fights for the freedom of others? In Europe, in two world wars, in Korea, in Vietnam, and yes, in Iraq. In all those wars, America had very little or nothing to gain economically. Whenever there is a humanitarian crisis anywhere in the world, Haiti after a hurricane, Indonesia after a tsunami, who is the first to rush aid to these places? No matter where the calamity is, at home or abroad, Americans invariably raise millions of dollars almost instantly to send food and clothing and supplies to people in distress they don't know and will never meet. Who else does that? I love that America is different. What worries me about America is that I see her increasingly trying to act like other nations. It worries me to see that so many Americans are drawn to the ossified ideas of Europe. That's the old world. It was old in 1776 even, when America broke away from it. Why would America want to reverse its own revolution? Why would Americans want to follow the economic and social model of a continent that they can see is failing economically and socially? Do Americans really want to emulate France or Greece? It worries me to see so many Americans wallowing in victim status, blaming outside forces for their predicament, rather than accepting responsibility and seeking to improve themselves. It worries me to see American schools debasing America's own glorious history. It worries me to see America's debt and government grow larger while its military and its personal freedoms shrink. It worries me because a weak, self-doubting America is bad for everyone, everywhere, who loves freedom. But these worries never last long, because each time I visit America, I encounter a people who are confident, competitive, courageous, faithful, idealistic, innovative, inspirational, charitable, and optimistic. It's like no other place in the world. I pray it stays that way. I'm Nick Adams for Prager University.
For all future stewards of the Earth, and that's all of us, here's a quick quiz. What is the most renewable and sustainable material with which to build our homes? How can we turn some of the CO2 we're putting into the atmosphere into an asset? And how can we make the world more beautiful and green? The answer to all these questions is trees. Trees make up about 90% of all the living biomass on Earth, and forests serve as home to the majority of species on the planet. We use thousands of products, many every day, that come from trees. Some are obvious, like wood and paper, and many not so obvious, like microcrystalline cellulose, a key ingredient in many medicines. Anyway, who doesn't love trees? Yet trees, especially in the last few decades, have become very controversial. People are divided into two broad camps. One group sees trees as a critical source of renewable material and of renewable energy. This group generally favors planting trees and making use of the many products derived from them. The other group emphasizes the value of forests as ecosystems to provide a protected habitat for threatened species. This group prefers to see forests off limits to commercial use. The arguments between these two groups can get pretty heated. But here's the good news. If we do it right, we can use our trees and enjoy them too. Before I explain how, I need to define two terms. The first is forestry, which means the creation, management, and use of forests. The second term is deforestation, which means the permanent loss of forests. There are two widespread misconceptions about forestry. The first misconception is that forestry, as practiced by the forest industry, is responsible for deforestation. We may think that when we buy wood from a lumberyard, we are causing a bit of forest to be lost somewhere. But what we're really doing is sending a signal to the marketplace to plant more trees, to produce more wood, to supply the demand in the lumberyard. It is no different from any other renewable crop. It's just that trees take longer to mature than annual farm crops. The giant paper company Boise Cascade is just as much in the business of planting trees as it is in harvesting them. The key point is it's not the harvesting of trees that causes deforestation. Deforestation is the result of harvesting and then not replanting a forest or not letting it grow back naturally, which it would do if just left alone. Deforestation sounds like a bad word, and it can be, but usually it's not. All it means is that after the trees are harvested, the land is used for a different purpose. The largest cause of deforestation is agriculture, the creation of new farmland. But farming is important. After all, the world has 7 billion people to feed. Another reason for deforestation is to make way for towns and cities. Manhattan was once a great forest. Now it's a great city. The second misconception about forestry is the tendency to judge landscapes by how they look to our eyes. We easily make the mistake of using our sense of what is beautiful and what is unsightly to judge the ecology of the land. This results in repulsion at the site of a recently logged landscape because it looks ravaged, destroyed, and unsightly. We don't react this way to a landscape of pasture with sheep peacefully grazing or a wheat field waving in the wind, yet both are examples of deforestation. Where there once was a biodiverse natural forest, we now have a ranch or a farm. In other words, we judge the book by the cover and equate beauty with ecological health and unsightliness with destruction of nature. These impressions have led many environmentalists to support cutting fewer trees, as if our forests are disappearing. But they're not. There is the same area of forest in the US and Canada today as there was 100 years ago. If anything, it's growing. This despite the fact that the population has tripled. But the professional environmentalists are never satisfied. They behave as if every tree should be protected and that the products they yield are unnecessary. This is badly misguided. The correct position, from a purely environmental perspective, is to grow more trees, the world's most abundant renewable resource, and use more wood. We can do both. In the end, we're all tree huggers. I'm Patrick Moore, co-founder of Greenpeace for Prager University.
Was the American Civil War fought because of slavery? More than 150 years later, this remains a controversial question. Why? Because many people don't want to believe that the citizens of the Southern states were willing to fight and die to preserve a morally repugnant institution. There has to be another reason, we are told. Well, there isn't. The evidence is clear and overwhelming. Slavery was, by a wide margin, the single most important cause of the Civil War, for both sides. Before the presidential election of 1860, a South Carolina newspaper warned that the issue before the country was the extinction of slavery, and called on all who were not prepared to surrender the institution to act. Shortly after Abraham Lincoln's victory, they did. The secession documents of every Southern state made clear, crystal clear, that they were leaving the Union in order to protect their peculiar institution of slavery, a phrase that at the time meant the thing special to them. The vote to secede was 169-0 in South Carolina, 166-7 in Texas, 84-15 in Mississippi. In no southern state was the vote close. Alexander Stephens of Georgia, the Confederacy's vice president, clearly articulated the views of the South in March 1861. Our new government, he said, was founded on slavery. Its foundations are laid. Its cornerstone rests upon the great truth that the Negro is not equal to the white man, that slavery, submission to the superior race, is his natural and normal condition. Yet despite the evidence, many continue to argue that other factors superseded slavery as the cause of the Civil War. Some argue that the South only wanted to protect states' rights. But this raises an obvious question. The states' rights to what? Wasn't it to maintain and spread slavery? Moreover, states' rights was not an exclusive Southern issue. All the states, North and South, sought to protect their rights. Sometimes they petitioned the federal government. Sometimes they quarreled with each other. In fact, Mississippians complained that New York had too strong a concept of states' rights because it would not allow Delta planters to bring their slaves to Manhattan. The South was preoccupied with states' rights because it was preoccupied first and foremost with retaining slavery. Some argue that the cause of the war was economic. The North was industrial and the South agrarian. And so, the two lived in such economically different societies that they could no longer stay together. Not true. In the middle of the 19th century, both North and South were agrarian societies. In fact, the North produced far more food crops than did the South. But Northern farmers had to pay their farmhands, who were free to come and go as they pleased, while Southern plantation owners exploited slaves over whom they had total control. And it wasn't just plantation owners who supported slavery. The slave society was embraced by all classes in the South. The rich had multiple motivations for wanting to maintain slavery. But so did the poor, non-slaveholding whites. The peculiar institution ensured that they did not fall to the bottom rung of the social ladder. That's why another argument that the Civil War couldn't have been about slavery because so few people owned slaves has little merit. Finally, many have argued that President Abraham Lincoln fought the war to keep the Union together, not to end slavery. That was true at the outset of the war, but he did so with the clear knowledge that keeping the Union together meant either spreading slavery to all the states, an unacceptable solution, or vanquishing it altogether. In a famous campaign speech in 1858, Lincoln said, "A house divided against itself cannot stand." What was it that divided the country? It was slavery and only slavery. He continued, "I believe this government cannot endure permanently half slave and half free. It will become all one thing or all the other." Lincoln's view never changed, and as the war progressed, the moral component, ending slavery, became more and more fixed in his mind. His Emancipation Proclamation in 1863 turned that into law. Slavery is the great shame of America's history. No one denies that. But it's to America's everlasting credit that it fought the most devastating war in its history in order to abolish slavery. As a soldier, I am proud that the United States Army, my army, defeated the Confederates. In its finest hour, soldiers wearing this blue uniform, almost 200,000 of them former slaves themselves, destroyed chattel slavery, freed 4 million men, women, and children from human bondage, and saved the United States of America. I'm Colonel Ty Sigely, professor and head, Department of History at the United States Military Academy, West Point, for Prager University.
Freedom of speech, the ability to express yourself, it's a cherished idea, as well it should be. Most of us who live in liberal Western democracies think of it as a basic human right. People have fought and died for it. But now we may be in danger of losing it. The threat is not coming from without, from external enemies, but from within. A generation is being raised not to believe in freedom of speech, but rather that they should have freedom from speech, from speech they dislike. This is a threat to both pluralism and democracy itself. We see this in Europe, where sensitivity-based censorship attempts to ban anything deemed hateful or even just hurtful, and to ban criticism of religion, especially Islam. But the United States, despite its strong constitutional protections in the Bill of Rights, is far from immune from the rising trend of suppression of speech, or what is sometimes called political correctness. This is especially true at America's colleges and universities, the place where our future leaders are educated and where you'd expect speech to be the most free. Highly restrictive speech codes are now the norm on campus, not the exception. According to a study by my organization, the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, FIRE, 54% of public universities and 59% of private universities impose politically correct speech codes on their students. And thanks to recent Department of Education guidelines, 100% of colleges may adopt speech codes in the coming years. How bad is it? At a public campus in California on Constitution Day in 2013, a student who also happens to be a decorated military veteran was told he could not hand out copies of the Constitution to his fellow students. The objection from the university was not ideological. It was out-of-control bureaucracy imposing limits on speech. That same day, another college student in that same state was told he could not protest NSA surveillance outside of a tiny free speech zone, an area that comprised only 1.37% of the campus. Months later, college students in Hawaii were told both they could not hand out the Constitution to their fellow students, and that they could not protest NSA policies outside the school's free speech zone. FIRE took these colleges to court, but the fact that we had to shows you how bad it has become. Recently, students and sympathetic faculty have joined forces to exclude campus speakers whose opinions they dislike. At FIRE, we call this disinvitation season, although the season lasts all year round. Since 2009, there has been a major uptick in the push by students and faculty to get speakers they dislike disinvited. These speakers have included former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice, the Somali-born feminist and critic of Islam Ayaan Hirsi Ali, and the director of the International Monetary Fund, Christine Lagarde. And that's only the obvious part of the disinvitation problem. Few conservative speakers are invited to speak at colleges lest they have to be disinvited later. The newest threat to speech comes from so-called trigger warnings, alerts that warn students that they are about to read or hear something that triggers a negative emotional response. A 2014 New York Times article cited the example of a Rutgers student requesting trigger warnings for the classic American novel The Great Gatsby because it, quote, possesses a variety of scenes that reference abusive, misogynistic violence, unquote. Recently, Oberlin College attempted to institute a policy that heavily encouraged the faculty to avoid difficult topics and to employ trigger warnings as a means of making classrooms safer. Safety has been watered down to essentially mean the right to always feel comfortable. New demands for trigger warnings are popping up on campuses across the country. Add in popular academic theories that encourage students to scrutinize speech for microaggressions, any statement that might be construed as racially insensitive, classist, sexist, or otherwise un-PC, and it's clear that campuses are teaching students to police what they say. This is precisely the opposite of what is needed. Our society needs candor, and it needs freedom of speech, not freedom from speech. Intellectual comfort is not a right, nor should it ever be. Not if we want freedom of speech, let's just call it freedom, to survive. I'm Greg Lukianoff, president of the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education for Prager University.
How did the framers of the Constitution of the United States seek to preserve liberty and prevent tyranny? Pretty basic question. Here's the answer I usually get from my students. Well, Professor, to protect the individual and minorities against the tyranny of the majority, they added the Bill of Rights, and they gave the power to enforce those rights to the Supreme Court.
Are my students correct?
The editorial boards of the New York Times or the Washington Post, and many members of the U.S. Congress, would say yes. Unfortunately, the answer is wrong. I say unfortunately because it reflects a common misunderstanding of the Constitution. And that misunderstanding has led to a serious erosion of our freedom. Let me explain. Both the Bill of Rights and judicial review, the idea that the courts can decide if a law is constitutional or not, were hotly debated items when the Constitution was being drafted in 1789. The Federalists, the group led by Alexander Hamilton that wanted a national constitution, opposed including a Bill of Rights. They feared it would actually undermine what the Federalists regarded as the main protections against tyranny in the document, the limited nature of the national government itself. The Constitution did not envision a national government of general jurisdiction, meaning a government that could do whatever it wanted, but rather a government of enumerated and delegated powers, a government that had authority over only specific areas of American life. All other powers were to be beyond the scope of the national government and reserved to the states or to the American people themselves. That's why when political necessity forced the Federalists to yield to demands for a Bill of Rights, they took care to add two important amendments, the 9th and 10th. The enumeration in the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people. And the powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution nor prohibited by it to the states are reserved to the states respectively or to the people. These amendments reinforce the idea that the national government couldn't just assume powers it had not been specifically granted by the Constitution. Unfortunately, these amendments have not stymied the expansion of the national authority. The power grab the Federalists feared, the national government taking more and more control over more and more areas of American life, took place. Not immediately, but over time, and especially beginning in the second half of the 20th century. That same time frame has seen a similar concentration of power in the judiciary, especially in the Supreme Court, so that now most Americans think of the Supreme Court as the ultimate arbiter of almost every social and political dispute. The founders never envisioned the court in this role. How has the court fared in playing it? Well, there have been moments of glory, to be sure, such as in the racial desegregation case of Brown against the Board of Education in the 1950s. But it has also handed down decision after decision, from Dred Scott against Sanford in the 1850s, which facilitated the expansion of slavery, to Roe against Wade in the 1970s, which legalized abortion throughout the United States, in which the justices have plainly overstepped the bounds of their authority by creating law from the bench, thereby further expanding their own power and that of the national government. Moreover, the Supreme Court has done little to stop the executive and legislative branches of the national government from unconstitutionally overreaching. Recently, the court found a way, by a bare majority, to uphold an obvious case of constitutional overreach by the national government, the imposition of a law, or individual mandate as it is known, requiring every citizen to purchase health insurance coverage as part of President Obama's signature Affordable Care Act. The government defended this mandate as a legitimate exercise of its expressly delegated power to regulate commerce among the states. The trouble is that the mandate does not regulate commerce at all. Rather, it forces people into commerce on pain of a financial penalty. But why did the issue get to the courts at all? Congress and the president should have recognized and honored the fact that the Constitution simply does not empower the national government to impose a mandate on the people to purchase products, whether health insurance or anything else. We've drifted a long way from the original vision of the founders. The further we've drifted, the more powerful the national government has grown, and the less free Americans have become. Freedom can be taken away, but it can also be given away out of sheer ignorance. If we Americans, we the people, want to get some of that freedom back, we need to read America's founding documents. All the freedom we ever wanted is there. I'm Robert George, professor of jurisprudence at Princeton University for Prager University.
Many people believe that free market capitalism is selfish, even immoral. They say it's about greed, about hunger for money and power, that it helps the rich and hurts the poor. They're wrong. The free market is not only economically superior, it is morally superior to any other way of organizing economic behavior. Here's why. The free market calls for voluntary actions between individuals. There's no coercion. In a free market, if I want something from you, I have to do something for you. Let's say I mow your lawn, and you pay me $20. What does that $20 really mean? When I go to the grocer and say, I would like to have 4 pounds of steak, he in effect says to me, you want a lot of people to serve you. Ranchers, truckers, butchers, and packagers. All these people have to be paid. What did you do to serve your fellow man? Well, I say, I mowed my fellow man's lawn. And the grocer says, prove it. Then I offer him the $20. Think of the money that you've earned as a certificate of performance. It's proof that you've served your fellow man. People accuse the free market of not being moral because they say it's a zero-sum game, like poker, where if you win, it means that I have to lose. But the free market is not a zero-sum game. It is a positive-sum game. You do something good for me, such as give me that steak, and I'll do something good for you, give you $20. I'm better off because I value the steak more than I value the $20, and the grocer is better off because he valued the $20 more than he valued the steak. We both win. Ironically, it's the government, not the free market, that creates zero-sum games in our economy. If you use the government to get a food stamp, a farm subsidy, or a business bailout, you will benefit, but at the expense of your fellow citizens. Isn't it more moral to require that people serve their fellow man in order to have a claim on what he produces, rather than not serve others and still have a claim? But a lot of people ask, what about giant corporations? Don't they have too much power over our lives? Not in a free market. Because in a free market, we the people decide the fate of companies who want our business. Free market capitalism will punish a corporation that does not satisfy customers or fails to use resources efficiently. Businesses, big and small, that wish to prosper are held accountable by the people who vote with their dollars. And again, it's the government that can undo this. Take the example of the American automobile industry. It was struggling to survive in 2009. Why? Because they were producing cars that did not please a sufficient number of their fellow men. In a free market, they would therefore have gone bankrupt. The market would have said, look, you're done. Sell your plant and equipment to somebody who can do a better job. But when Chrysler and General Motors failed, they went to Washington, D.C. and got the government to bail them out. The government bailout essentially meant to them, you don't have to be accountable to customers and stockholders. No matter how inferior your product is, and no matter how inefficient you are, we'll keep you in business by taking your fellow man's money. When the government interferes in this way, it takes the power away from the people and rewards companies that couldn't compete successfully in the marketplace. That may work out very well for politicians, big unions, and corporate officers, but it seldom does for the taxpayer. That's why a free market system can only work if there is limited government. Limited government means you and I decide which businesses survive. That's the America that our founding fathers envisioned, a limited government that has only a few specifically mentioned or enumerated powers that are listed in Article 1, Section 8 of the United States Constitution. It's this brilliant limited government notion that produced the wealthiest nation in history. In a free market, the ambition and the voluntary effort of citizens not the government, drives the economy. That is, people, to the best of their ability, shaping their own destiny. Sounds pretty moral to me. I'm Walter Williams of George Mason University for Prager University.
One of the most persistent claims in the climate debate is that global warming leads to more extreme weather. This is a common concern expressed by those who fear a dangerously warming planet. President Barack Obama did so eloquently in his 2013 State of the Union address when he talked about the devastating impact of raging fires and crippling drought and more powerful storms. Many others have offered similar sentiments. Global warming is a problem that needs to be addressed, but exaggeration doesn't help and often distracts us from simple, cheaper, and smarter solutions. To find those solutions, let's address the three horsemen of the climate apocalypse to which President Obama referred. Historical analysis of wildfires around the world shows that since 1950, their numbers have decreased globally by 15%. Estimates published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences shows that even with global warming, the level of wildfires will continue to decline until mid-century and won't resume on the level of 1950, the worst for fire, before the end of the century. Claiming that droughts are a consequence of global warming is also wrong. The world has not seen a general increase in drought. A study published in Nature in March 2014 shows globally that there's been little change in drought over the past 60 years. The UN Climate Panel in 2012 concluded, some regions of the world have experienced more intense and longer droughts, in particular in southern Europe and West Africa. But in some regions, droughts have become less frequent, less intense, or shorter, for example, in central North America and northwestern Australia. And finally, the third horseman, hurricanes. Global hurricane activity today, measured by total energy, hasn't been lower since the 1970s. While it's likely that we will see somewhat stronger, but fewer, storms as climate change continues, damages will be lower because we'll be better adapted. A March 2012 Nature study shows that the global damage cost from hurricanes will be 0.02% of gross domestic product by 2100, down 50% from today's 0.04%. Let me make this clear. This does not mean that climate change isn't an issue. It means that exaggerating the threat concentrates resources in the wrong areas. Consider hurricanes, though similar points hold for wildfire and drought. If the aim is to reduce storm damage, then first focus on resilience, better building codes, and better enforcement of those codes. Ending subsidies for hurricane insurance to discourage building in vulnerable zones would also help, as would investing in better infrastructure, from stronger levees to higher capacity sewers. These solutions are quick and comparatively cheap. Most important, they would diminish future hurricane damage, whether climate-induced or not. Had New York and New Jersey focused resources on building seawalls and adding storm doors to the subway system and making simple fixes like porous pavements, Hurricane Sandy would have caused much less damage. In the long run, the world needs to cut carbon dioxide because it causes global warming. But if the main effort to cut emissions is through subsidies for chic renewables like wind and solar power, virtually no good will be achieved at very high cost. The cost of climate policies just for the European Union, intended to reduce emissions by 2020 to 20% below 1990 levels, are estimated at about $250 billion annually, or about $20 trillion over the century. And the benefits, when estimated using a standard climate model, will reduce temperatures only by an immeasurable 1/10 of a degree Fahrenheit by the end of the century. Even in 2040, under its most optimistic scenario, the International Energy Agency estimates that just 2.2% of the world's energy will come from wind and solar. As is the case today, almost 80% will still come from fossil fuels. As long as green energy is more expensive than fossil fuels, growing consumer markets like those in China and India will continue mostly to be powered by them. Solar, wind, and other renewables are still inefficient because they require subsidies of more than $120 billion a year. And even in 2040, they won't be efficient, the International Energy Agency estimates they will still require more than $200 billion annually. Instead of pouring money into subsidies for existing inefficient wind and solar energy, we'd be far better off supporting research and development of green energy technologies to make them cheaper, faster. When innovation eventually makes green energy as cheap or cheaper than fossil fuel energy, everyone will use it, including China and India. Until then, let's cool the fear-mongering and make practical decisions that will help people now. I'm Bjorn Lomborg, president of the Copenhagen Consensus Center.
Thank you for watching this video. To help keep PragerU videos free, please consider making a tax-deductible donation.